It's your world, baby, and everything in it belongs to you. Go on and hurt me if that's what you wanna do. I know we're soon gonna part, so go on and make your start and do what you set out to do.
Peace and blessings. This is Lisa Marie Goodson of In Our Own Image on the Afrocentric Home Decor and Style Channel. And on today's show, we are going to be in the kitchen learning how to make some delicious raw, I like to call them pizza kale chips. Also, join us outside in the sun where we're going to talk about how you can not just Afrocentric your fashion, but do it with color. We're also going to have an interview with the beautiful Sarah Blanchett, who is a dynamic, powerful, intelligent sister, and we're going to talk about enslaved Africans and their role in the gold mining industry in North Carolina. And lastly, we're going to talk about masks. Masks from Benin, masks from Nigeria, masks from all over the world, their significance, their value, and their beauty. Hope you enjoy. Peace and blessings. Ladies, welcome to our home decor segment of the show In Our Own Image. It's always a pleasure to have you in the home. And today we're going to talk about decorating with African masks. We're going to learn a little bit about African masks, the different masks that come from different areas of Africa, the continent of Africa, which is comprised of many countries. And so this is a brief, for, you know, further information. I'll actually leave a couple of links in the description box so you can get more information about masks. But we're going to talk about my husband and I. We may have him chime in. A lot of the masks are his. About the idea of just why we decided that we wanted masks, why masks I think are important, how you can beautify your home with the masks. That's a wonderful, easy way to have Afrocentric elements to your home. And I think it's great for everyone. What I like about masks is if you're into the modern, you know, kind of design, where you have those, you know, clean lines, you know, very, you know, minimalist kind of designs, and I think, and you want to have Afrocentric without, you know, like just shouting it out, I think that's a wonderful, classy way to have a mask. So you can have one or you can have many. If you're more of, you want to make a statement and more and look, have more of a collection, then I think my husband and I mask is going to actually answer that for you. If you're a person that like to take the mask and split them up throughout the house and put them in different areas, that's kind of me and my style, as well as a collection. I like a little bit of everything. I like the single ones as well. Then we're going to talk about that as well. So without further ado, let's get started. So my husband's going to start showing you all the masks, and I'm going to come over there so that I can talk about it. So this is not about me. Hold on. This is about you. Okay. So let's get this mask thing. So if you look up there right now, you'll notice that this is all my husband's masks, and he's collected them over many years. How many years would you say, Warren? Okay, 20 years. So because the reason why I asked you was someone had a question about to me is how long did it take you to collect the masks? Did you buy them all together or did you buy them one at a time? And I think for a lot of people, you know, one people might say, what do you look for when you're looking for masks? Well, one of the things that you look for, and actually I can come out here still and you don't have to see me, but one of the things you want to look for when you're looking for masks is what appeals to you. I mean, it's really that simple. What do you like? What appeals to you? What is it about that? What stood out? If you were on a website or eBay or Etsy or Amazon or other places, particularly eBay or anywhere, if you was in an African shop or African store, what got your attention? what captured you. Don't worry about the country at this point. Don't worry about even the meaning at this point. First, for me, I would look at what excites me, what got my attention, and what I love. What about you, Warren, when you were picking out the mask? Was that kind of your motivation as well?
Authenticity, shape, color, country.
So let me say, I'm talking about, okay, good. Thank you for that. I'm glad to know. Well, when you initially saw the mask on the site, did you get to, were you attracted to it first? And
well,
then those other things?
Because there's a big difference between tourist mask,
right,
and authentic mask.
Okay.
So that's why I said the authenticity you can see right away when you look at it. I mean, of course, there's shape, color, material as well. And of course, something captures you about the mask. But you can look and tell whether it's an old or a new mask.
Okay, so we're going to get to the authenticity in a second. So thank you. I appreciate it. My husband's saying the same thing I'm saying is I think even with any piece of art, because I look at masks as art too. Yes, first what attracts you. Now you might find be attracted to something that it is. It's a tourist mask or it's a mask. And you might say, you know what, in this case, I don't want it. But I mean, what I don't want you to do, and a lot of people may do it, and you can actually. Some people buy art that they don't like, but they hope it's going to appreciate. And so I guess what I'm getting at is trying to get you to understand that no one can really tell you which mask that you should like. It's really about what attracts you. So that, and then you can start getting the specs on those things once you decide on what attracts you. You may even have a place in mind in your home for a mask. So in that case, you might want to look at size. You might say, wow, I have a small space where I think this mask would be perfect. Or I have a small space where I think this mask would be perfect. Or I have a large place. Maybe you want to use a mask as a centerpiece. A mask over a fireplace, or a mask, maybe not the best place, or a mask over a mantle is what I would say, because a lot of times people have fireplaces that don't have fire, so it's fine. Or a mask over a couch. So I look for all that. You may actually also look for color. For you, it may be like, I there's something about this mask here, and I love the woman and the red. See, that red catches me. So if you're into matching according to your decor, then masks could actually be helpful for that. Also, you may be really digging that yellow one because you're attracted to the color. Another thing why I tend to like this one and all these is I like the kind of what I call almost the hair around the mask. You may want more like lifelike masks. You may want masks that have double meanings or masks that has animals and humans. So there's a lot of different ways to talk about and decide on which mask do you want. And then, of course, where to get it. So this is, and I'm going to put a link to the sister's video. She talked about masks in Africa, and she said that there's really no way to know the artist of the mask. Maybe you can know the mask by tribe because there's features or certain masks that people make. Another thing about mask making is she also talked about the idea that it's usually just like a drummer in Africa or a dancer in Africa. You come from a line of mask makers or line of drummers or a line of dancers. So mask is the same way. These people have made masks for generations. Their father, their father's father, their father's father, and so on. And a lot of times, too, as a woman who actually purchased masks, one of the mask vendors, she talked about that. The only way to really know the age, now this is what she says, I'm sure there's different opinions, that's my husband, she said is to trust from the vendor that knows the mask, that is telling you that that mask is this, how much, this many years old or that many years old, because a lot of times the mask is not necessarily going to have, you know, 1865 on it. Most likely they're not going to have that at all. Is that right?
Right?
And that's what she's saying. There's no way to, you know, have, there's no etching in it. Because in Africa, the artists and artisans and mask makers believe that they are not the artist, that the artist is the Most High, the Creator, or God. And so because they believe in that, they don't sign the mask, and they don't date the mask. So for her, she said that you have to learn, you know it because the people you're dealing with, you're trusting, and you're knowing that these are the people that know about the mask. But there's other things I'm sure you can tell by, like, some of the way it looks, maybe the process, the aging process. There's some of them that might look like that anyway. But one way to know is definitely knowing your vendor, if you can know that. And there's a lot of places you can go to flea markets. Also, you can have a store that you may trust the vendor or the owner of the store. So definitely ask about the mask and the history. If you can get a story about the mask, that's always good. And of course, the people, because a lot of times the people of Mali do make a certain type of mask or style. And speaking of that, a lot of the masks are for different reasons. A lot of masks are for ceremonial reasons. A lot of masks are for a wedding. A lot of masks are for death or funerals, and all honesty. A lot of masks are for to bring you good prosperity and abundance. A lot of the masks are for to heal somebody, the sick, a mask for fertility, like the fertility mask. They actually have those in so-called dolls even. So all of these are really representing something. Some of them are for happy marriages. Some of them are for to ward off evil spirits. So every mask has a purpose. And so always think about that when you're buying masks, that they all have a purpose, whether you know it or not, whether your vendor knows it or not, they do. That's why I kind of say, you know, go with your spirit and what you're feeling as well, so that you can pick out something that's good for you. So like I said, I'll definitely leave some links in the description box. Let's talk about decor and, again, styling. Now, my husband chose, I think he said he always did it, he chose to always keep the mask together. And I like that. I think it really helps to display. Is that right? You always did? Okay. Help to display a collection. It actually lets you know all the masks that you do have. And I think it has a wonderful impact for the people that come to visit. It's really beautiful. So we have this beautiful wall, as you see, almost like wall to ceiling. This is a somewhat loft apartment. It is a loft apartment. And I love the way my husband chose to decorate. So I'm going to ask him, hopefully it won't be too much, but to ask him, what was your motivation for putting up the mask this way?
Keeping them together or just placement?
Placement.
Well, of course, I started in the center. And then I worked outward.
Okay.
With the circles, uh-huh. The round mask. Uh-huh. I too was attracted to the rattan, the hair, mm-hmm. around the mask, and it makes a big statement, I believe. And I tried to put like mask or shape.
Okay.
Starting outward from the center.
Love that.
And if you notice, I have the Nigerian masks with the big crowns on the top, at least the one on the left. And then there's a similar one with a crown on the right.
Right, okay.
Almost in the identical spots. Mm-hmm. And then staggering, you know, how I place them. Mm-hmm. But it's all so organic or natural when I start placing them. Mm-hmm. It's not like I really thought a whole lot about it, but when I began to place them, then the rest kind of falls into place. Mm-hmm. A lot of placing, yeah. So yeah, I mean, it kind of dictates where the next one will go, and to try and have a sort of balance between the left and right. Mm-hmm. So one side is not as heavy. So I have a round on the right, and I have a round, mm-hmm. on the left as well, mm-hmm. And hair on the left and hair on the right. Mm-hmm. So I try to produce a balance in shape, size, style. Mm-hmm. Is my method for placement. Yeah.
Well, it's very beautiful. People admire it all of the time. So price range, masks can run you between what and what? I've seen masks for $150. I've seen them as low as $75, but they can be even more than that. Isn't that correct?
Yeah. They can, yeah,
hundred.
Yeah, 500. Mm-hmm. Yeah, thousands even.
Right.
And the older it gets, of course, the more it's going to cost. Mm-hmm. But again, like you said, they aren't signed and they aren't dated, so.
So you have to trust the vendor.
Yeah. Sometimes it's you can kind of look and see mm-hmm. the wear and the wood, the weathering, mm-hmm. And sometimes not.
Right. Exactly. So, and also too, remember too that the masks, and you can also do that too, don't get stuck on collecting masks all from one country unless you just really love those masks from that country. And if somebody can be able to even tell you that, again, most of the time you'll probably have masks that's from throughout the continent of Africa, and I think that's a really beautiful thing to do. There's some other, let me give you some other suggestions of, again, as I talked about before, if my husband get over here, this in a sense is a mask as well, and so it is a mask, so I don't think they saw that. And there's a lot of different ones like that I've seen, very similar. That's a beautiful statement, like I absolutely love that. So I wanted to say, that's right, and the mask that's over here as well. Can you tell us a little bit about these masks?
Oh, those are helmet masks, they call them. They're usually, well, of course, placed on top of the head. With these also had rattan that hung from the bottom of it, so it's placed on top of the head. They're usually kept on stands, but yeah, I don't have a stand right now. But and they're these I know are from Sierra Leone.
Okay,
Sierra Leone. The Mende people.
Your people.
My people. Yeah.
You just happened to have that,
yeah,
didn't
I
know.
Just happened to collect them before I found out that my lineage went back to the Mende people.
Excellent.
So I was ahead of the curve.
Well, thank you. Okay, so we'll just go back here. And so that's the wonderful thing that I find too, you know, just a spiritual note, is that a lot of times you probably will find a mask that's from your country. Yeah. The mask that I was attracted to that's in the guest room is actually from the Cameroon. And it was also a mask in Ngozi Boutique in Durham, North Carolina. They had a mask that I was so attracted to on the table, many masks from different parts of Africa, different countries in Africa. The one I was attracted to is the one from the Cameroon. So don't be surprised that you'll be attracted to that. Now again, you don't have to do the collection. Maybe you have a small space and a lot of masks. So you can start thinking about different places. Masks at the front door is a lot, very much traditional for a lot of people as protection. Masks in the bathroom is what actually I keep my mask. We have a mask over there in the dining room. That's one of my husband's other masks as well. Mask in the dining room, mask in the living room, mask in the bedroom. Actually, I do have some masks actually in the bedroom as well. So I think that the idea of decorating with masks is so wonderful. Again, I will leave a link to a video on YouTube with a woman, a sister, actually talking more about masks if you want to know more information. Also, like again, places that my husband got the mask from, that is the big question that they all had. So where did you find these masks?
From vendors. Well, you know, Musa, I got some.
So local, so local vendors?
Local vendors at the market, the farmer's market.
Or flea market. Well, let me just say for them, so they could find them at, they should check their local vendors, whether that's a farmer's market, flea market, festivals, is that right? Absolutely. And also, I was thinking, so, oh, and some, there's actually African shops in most people's cities, so you suggest all of those places?
Yeah.
Okay, what about online? Did you get some online?
And a lot of them on eBay.
Okay.
Yeah, you can find a lot of masks on eBay.
Okay, good. So you can find a lot of masks. And sometimes they'll give you some information that they know they might have, where it's from. And
yes, yes. It's usually in the description of the item, at least what they know about it.
Yeah, and I wanted to address one last thing, because I'm going to actually come down this way to do it. So this is something that a lot of people have shared with me, and I think we should address it. A lot of people are afraid of masks because their religion told them that masks was evil, or that masks were bad, right? Or that masks were going to make your life horrible if you put it in your home. And actually, the opposite is true. You know, meanwhile, why? And this is all really coming from Europeans. Europeans were telling you that the mask was evil, but most of the masks that are being sold originally, and a lot of masks that are not really being owned by Africans, they owned by Europeans. They have masks in most of the European countries, whether they're in the basements of their museums or whether they're on the walls of their homes. So even at the time that they were telling blacks that masks were evil, that masks were dangerous, if you will, they were actually collecting masks. So again, I'm going to leave the link to that video that talks a little more about that. So it's this whole idea of how to colonize you and control you. And one way is to dehumanize you and make you feel like anything that has to do with your culture is not beautiful. And so the ways to do that is to tell you that anything created by you is not beautiful and it's ugly. But yet they kept the mask. They understood the value of it. They understood the artistry in it and they understood the beauty. And these masks were stolen. In most cases, we always talk about the cargo, the human cargo that came to us through our horrendous trip from the continent of Africa to the Americas. And we talk about the human cargo, but they didn't just steal people. They stole artifacts. They stole masks. They stole spices. They stole seeds. They stole weapons, spears, and shields. And they stole, and of course, they stole people. So you have to remember all of that, that your beauty was always revered by the same people that make you feel like you're less than and you're ugly. It was revered. Another thing to remember too about masks is masks in African culture represent life. It represented everyday life. Africans didn't make anything that wasn't going to aid them to have a better life. So the masks were really made for the wedding, for the fertility. Masks were made for war or prayer or protection. It's the life that they're reflecting through their masks, not just for show. So we're very lucky, very fortunate that when we in these countries that we live in, that we're able to take a mask or have a mask and be able to display it in a way. I do think that your mask should be in an area where people really can't knock them over. I think the moment you put it on the wall, you give reverence to them. And so in order to continue to have that great connection between you and your ancestors, you want to make sure they're not knocked over, things of that nature. And also remember that you are creating a connection. You're going back to your lineage and you're remembering that which you are. And masks have a wonderful way to do that. So I hope you enjoyed this segment of mask buying, mask producing. And there's a lot of stuff on YouTube about masks, but I'd say stay within the positive and understand that this is us. So I want to thank you so much for this segment of home decor and styling and how you can have African masks in your home. I'll see you in the next video. Peace and blessings. Peace and blessings, ladies, and thank you for joining me in the kitchen for another edition of In Our Own Image. I hope that you love what we talked about with the masks, and I hope you will start bringing some African masks in your home. But right now, we're going to talk about one of my favorite dishes. So as many of you know, I am a raw foodist, which means I eat predominantly raw. I would say I'm 100%, but every once in a while, I cheat. And so one of the foods that I cheat with, and is my weakness, everybody has an Achilles heels, and I got one too, and mine is potato chips. I love chips every time. Honey Dijon chips, original chips, crinkle cut chips, I don't care, any kind of chips, even like, you know, peas chips or okra chips. It doesn't matter. If it's a chip, I want it. And so what I do is I don't really want it because it takes me down a road of eating really poorly and I don't want to do it. So one day, a long time ago, my raw food teacher came to me with a recipe and she said, I want you to try these kale chips. And they are raw. And so basically we're going to be using a dehydrator. I'm going to show you that later. And so what she did was show me how to make kale chips in a dehydrator that will rival any chip out there. As a matter of fact, I don't like any chips as much as I love the kale chip. I don't like anyone as much as I love these kale chips. And what I love, I think the secret is in these kale chips is actually, I'm going to call it the batter. It's what we coat the kale in. This is what makes the difference. And so we're going to talk about what that is today. So when I first had these chips with my mentor, Mama Carmelita Taylor from Oakland, California, gave me this recipe. What I loved about them, and then I ate them, was that they were so delicious and they reminded me of pizza. So I call them pizza chips. You may not get the same thing feeling, but that's exactly what I got. And even my daughter loved it. Your children will love it. So let's talk a little bit about the ingredients that's in this particular recipe. The ingredients are going to be sun-dried tomatoes. So this is what I'm calling the batter. This is what we're going to coat the kale with. Sun-dried tomatoes. Now, if you do, you can do fresh tomatoes. And you would change the recipe. For fresh tomatoes, it's 1 cup of fresh tomatoes. But if you do sun-dried tomatoes, then it's 2 cups. These have been soaked. So they've been soaked for about probably a good 4 to 5 hours. I say you can soak them anywhere from 30 minutes before. I would not soak them overnight. I used to do that unless they are good quality. And in California, I feel like we had a better quality of sun-dried tomatoes. But you can soak this 30 minutes prior. You just want it soft and really nice. Because you want it really kind of loose but still have a little thickness. So basically it's like preparing your own spaghetti sauce. So we're going to do 2 cups of sun-dried tomatoes. Again, if you want to go totally fresh, then you can do 1 cup of 1 cup of regular tomatoes, you know, fresh tomatoes. We're going to do 3/4 cups of olive oil. We're going to do 2 tablespoons of minced garlic. We're going to use 1 teaspoon of Italian seasoning. We're also going to use 2 teaspoons of lemon juice. So this is squeezed fresh lemon. And we're also going to do, the recipe calls for 1 teaspoon of, what do you call this? It's not even here. But 1 teaspoon of red pepper flakes, and actually it is red pepper flakes, but I'm going to do 1/2 teaspoon. I've been making this for so long that I know exactly how I want it to taste. Now, if you like things more spicier, you like things more peppery, then go for a whole teaspoon. But for me, I notice that's a little too spicy for me, especially going through menopause. I mean, I don't need anything else to get me hot, make me sweat, so I do 1/2 tea. So adjust it to your likings, and it's really that simple. And of course, we're going to use the kale. What would kale chips be without kale? So the kale chips is actually, this is a 1 bunch of kale. So I'm going to actually make 2 bunches of kale, but this is the 1 bunch of kale. So what I'm going to do is get this all together, and then we're going to put on a dehydrating tray, and we're going to put it in the oven, and you're going to see the beauty of it. And the taste is so delicious. You will love it, and it's healthy for you. I find that after having the kale chips, especially from the dehydrator, I find that my bowel movements are amazing. I feel very nourished. I feel like I'm getting all my nutrients. It's almost like a meal in itself. Remember, why are we using a dehydrator instead of the oven? Because you could, I'm sure, use the oven on a very low temperature and put it in the oven. I never did it, so I don't know, but I know other people that have, and they say the lowest temperature you can. What I do is, what I love about a dehydrator is it still keeps the active enzymes. Enzymes are what help you to digest your food, you to digest your food. So enzymes are like the most amazing thing that really helps you to feel good when you're eating instead of feeling bloated. Another thing, it protects it so it doesn't pull out all of the vitamins and minerals like an oven does, because your dehydrator is just really taking out the water. And also it's cooked on, and even the dehydrators, we're using it, we're going to turn the dehydrator to 115 degrees. Now, the recipe says 115 degrees for 8 hours. It depends on your dehydrator. We have a pretty big dehydrator at this point, and I learned this, that it really only requires, for me, 115 degrees, the same thing, but 4 hours, and it's ready, and I love it. And we'll talk more about the dehydrator when we get to that point, but let's actually make this delicious sauce. So the first thing that we're going to do is we're going to put in our sun-dried tomatoes. And I'm going to tell you, ladies, you're going to use your hands when you do raw foods. Oh, that's right. Well, the second thing we're going to put on our apron. Because you don't want to mess up your fit, and you don't want to get germs in your food. So let's cover ourselves up here. Okay, so we put the 2 cups of sun-dried tomatoes in the food processor. Remember, I always tell you every week, I say to you, or every month, that the food processor is your best friend in the raw food kitchen. The food processor, the blender, and the dehydrator. Now we're going to add to the 2 cups of sun-dried tomatoes that were soaked, we're going to add 3/4 cup of olive oil. To that, we're going to add the 2 tablespoons. Of minced garlic, this is going to be very deliciously garlicky, which I'm loving. To that, and I want to make sure I got that. I want to make sure, is it 2 tablespoons? This is what I feel like, it's the Italian seasoning that really gives it, and it's a combination of everything that gives it that pizza feel. But I want to make sure that the two tablespoons of Italian seasoning, you can get this in your herb section at your local supermarket, and 2 tablespoons. Thank you, darling. And no, I don't think that's why. That's why I brought 2 teaspoons. So I was right. Thank you. So you can get this at your local, anywhere where they sell your herbs and spices in your local supermarket, already bottled. So it's not like you have to get it at a health food store. You can get it anywhere. So we're going to do 2 teaspoons of the Italian seasoning. I think, like, really go out your way to get this, because I feel like it really makes this wonderful sauce that we're about to put on. And then we didn't put in our lemon juice. So we're going to do that as well. Again, I want to just refer to, so the lemon juice is 2 teaspoons. You can put more or less to taste. So I'm going to pour that in as well. And the last thing is, I believe, the sun-dried tomato. So we have, and let's just go over it again. So we have 2 cups of soaked sun-dried tomatoes. We did 3/4 cups of olive oil, 2 tablespoons of freshly minced garlic, 2 teaspoons of Italian seasoning, 2 teaspoons of lemon juice. Now we're going to do our salt. So I like to use, as you'll probably notice, it's the Himalayan pink sea salt. So I'm going to do 1 1/4 teaspoon of this, okay? So I'm going to do 1 teaspoon, and then I'm going to do 1/4. So here we go. So here's the tea, and this is fine. So I'm going to do 1 tea. And then I'm going to do 1/4. And I find that this measurement really works well. You're really going to love it. And I think it's not too much or too little. I think it's perfect. So, and then the last thing, remember, the recipe says 1 tea of red pepper flakes, but not me. I've learned that. I like a 1/2 tea of red pepper flakes, and I find that it makes it just perfect. Because remember, too, you got the garlic in there as well, which is also going to provide a certain kind of spice. So I want to make sure that I don't overdo it with the pepper, and that's it. So we're going to get this dehydrator together. We're going to turn it on, and you know me, let me just get rid of some things. So I really hope you'll try these recipes. You're going to find that they're so delicious. And you know what, even if you're not raw or even a vegan, we can all add more vegan foods to our lives, because we know that this, you know, shown that vegan plant-based diets are, you know, good for preventing cancer, diabetes, high blood pressure, a lot of things that are prevalent in our community as African Americans and Africans in the diaspora. So we want to make sure, because this is important to me, the reason why I show you these healthy meals is because we need them. It's just that simple.
I don't eat no meat, no dairy, no sweets, only ripe vegetables, fresh fruit and whole wheat. I'm from the old school, my household smell like soul food, bruh. Curry falafel, barbecue tofu, no fish though, no candy bars, no cigarettes, only ganja, fresh squeezed juice from oranges. Exercising daily to stay healthy, and I rarely drink water out the tap cause it's filthy. Lentil soup is mental fruit, and ginger root is good for the youth. Fresh vegetable with them ice high stew.
Okay, so I'm going to ask my husband to pass me a spoon. Actually, I think I see one. Do I see one in here? Yes. Okay, good. Because what you want to do, you know, with anything, you want to definitely check it to see. It's very delicious. But it does, of course, need to go a little longer.
With the green callaloo. Careful how you season and prepare your foods, cause you don't want to lose vitamins and minerals, and that's the jewel. Life brings life, it's valuable. So I eat what comes from the ground, it's natural. Let your food be your medicine, no excedrin. Strictly herb generates from the sun, cause I got melanin and drink water. 8 glasses a day, cause that's what they say. They say you are what you eat, so I strive to eat healthy. My goal in life is not to be rich or wealthy, cause true wealth comes from good health and wise ways. We got to start taking better care of ourselves. They say you are what you eat, so I strive to eat healthy. My goal in life is not to be rich or wealthy, cause true wealth comes
from. And if you did soak the sun-dried tomatoes overnight, it would definitely cut down on the processing, which means, you know, getting this to kind of be nice and soft. But, you know, it's all good. It's okay. Let me taste it a little more. see if all the ingredients have mixed well. Very delicious. The more I mix it, the better it tastes. So we're gonna keep going.
Health and wise ways, we got to start taking better care of ourselves. We healthy, y'all. It's all love, it's all love, it's all love.
We're going to see. I think it needs a little more. It has a nice, you want a nice thickness, you want a nice consistency. That always helps. But you also want the sun-dried tomato itself to be broken down. Well, it still feels chewy, so I'm going to let it go a little longer.
Eat your greens. Stop hesitate. Eat your greens. Okay, may I wait? Eat your greens, dark and leafy. No greens to be left on the plate. What's the matter? Fix your face. Can't make those greens go to waste. Greens are good for you. Greens are great. You never know. Go and investigate. Ups your vitamin intake. Nutrients that your body can't make. They protect, maintain.
All right, y'all. So we have the sauce. Perfect. It's delicious. Has a nice spice. I can taste Italian seasoning. I can taste the lemon juice. I can taste everything. So this is when they say in the raw kitchen, you have to get raw. So you're going to use your hands to actually put in the sauce into the kale chips, and or actually the kale itself. So we took the kale and we de-stemmed them. So there was a stem in the middle, like stem and collard greens. You take the actual kale off the stem, because when this dries, it's very just kind of, it's almost, it can actually even poke you. It's just not very edible. So we know this is fine a little bit, but we took most of the stems off. And so what I'm going to do now is I'm going to take the sauce. Now a little, remember we have another, this is one bunch of kale, and sitting over there we have another bunch of kale. So this has to go between two, and I'm usually doing it does. So the name of the game is to get your hands in there and get the sauce all over. So on every piece. So we want to make sure we do that. And you know, I would say get a bigger bowl if you have one, because this is the time. And so basically what you're doing is you're marinating all the kale with the sauce. And you'll see as you start squeezing the kale with the sauce, and I'm sure my husband is getting this, as you start squeezing the kale with the sauce, you'll have a place to put this. Okay, we'll just keep that there. You'll notice that it'll get softer, the kale itself. So the kale is really works well with anything you put on it. You know, when I make a salad, this is the same thing I do. I use olive oil, a little sea salt, a little spike seasoning, and I do the same thing. So it's like you're, you know, massaging the kale, and you will see when you put in a dehydrator and it comes out the dehydrator, it's very concentrated. So it's really delicious. So it's very concentrated and it's really nice. So like I said, make sure that you get, and I'm going to put a little more. Make sure that you use a bigger bowl, because you don't want to waste none of that kale. And really, I'm about to put that kale back in, because I cleaned my countertops thoroughly. So I'm going to actually not waste anything. And so, yeah, it's getting nice and moist. And you want, what you're looking for is making sure that there's no dry kale leaves. And you're just getting your hands in there. And this is going to make some delicious kale. You see how I'm kind of even rubbing, because I can see spots that don't have it. So I want to make sure that it does. You want to get in that middle. You want to get on the bottom. And as you massage, because it does have olive oil in it, as you massage, it will start to shrink a bit, which is exactly what you want. So you want that shrinkage. I'm going to put a little more because I know I'll have enough for the other one. Just get that little more in. And remember, when you're doing the sauce and the dehydrator, go as long as you need to as far as the consistency you want the sauce to be. You want the sun-dried tomatoes to be fully blended, okay, to be fully chopped down. You don't, unless, you know what though, I'll be honest with you, chunks, there's nothing wrong with chunks. There's nothing at all wrong with the chunks, because if you like that taste, that could be nice as well. So it's whatever you want, however you want it. Play with it a few. You know, you could do other toppings too. But my mentor, the way she taught me was she made several. She made this one. She made one with just salt. One with garlic. So as far as the kale chips, you could do it any way you want. Okay, so I'm feeling this right now. You see how I'm still rubbing though? I'm still rubbing. So, So what I'm gonna do before I mess with that, I'm just gonna put it to the side. Because if I need more, then I'll fix that. So here's the second batch. And I like to start with a little, see what I need. And then we're gonna do the same thing. Same thing. What I love about kale is such a hearty green. Kale has gotten a lot of, you know, write-ups, and people are loving kale because kale is so good for so many things. I'm gonna put this right here. It's a great and powerful blood cleanser. Greens in general really do clean the blood. And actually blood builders really more, you know. Because like red foods are really good for cleansing the blood, which makes a lot of sense. But green foods or greens are good for building the blood. And a lot of us, you know, a lot of disease is actually, you know, really, we can find it or it lives in the blood. So you want to keep it highly oxygenated. That's what's so good about kale or raw foods. And for those that are new to raw foods are just food like this kale that we don't actually cook. And we eat it and we make wonderful things with it, like salads, or right now we're making a nice chip with it. So this is why this is so important, because it actually, when foods are kept, the belief is, when foods are kept in its natural state and then consumed also in its natural state, your body loves it and digests it, and you get the full nutrients and the benefits of the kale. So what I do, and if you want to go to the recipe, I said two bunches for that batch, but if you want to get technical, you can say 8 cups of kale to the batch that we just made. So mine is 2. Sometimes I tried to do 3 bunches with the same sauce, and it just didn't cover it enough for me. So I feel like I finally perfected it. You know, things will vary too. When we were in California, I remember the kale taking a little longer than 4 hours. So I believe that the outside temperature will affect the kale itself. So, you know, check it. And when you put it in that dehydrator, which is so great, we have a time on ours, so it'll stop in the hours that we set it. So I'm going to set it for 4. I'm going to even set it for 5, and I'll check it in 4. So do the same thing. You made yours at 4 hours, may not work, it may need 8. So check it periodically and look at it and see if it's where you need it to be, because it's all about you. And your children, I'm telling you, they will love this. Other things, you can think of other things. I was thinking of nutritional yeast can be part of this. Chips, if you want that on it. So I'm sure there's endless amount of things that you could think of. Now, one thing about kale chips, it does take time, because you have to get all of this in. You have to take the kale off the stalk. But it's so worth it in the end. So my thing is, I would make 2 batches. Sometimes I make 2 batches of the sun-dried tomato, because I want to actually make 2 batches of the kale. So this is one, I call this one batch, one and one, and then I make another one. So because they go so fast, and because it's taking 4 hours or 4 to 8 hours to get done, right? I won't say cook. To get done, you might want to think about making a lot, so that you feel like, well, for all that time, let me make sure I make a lot, because it's highly addictive. So I'm loving the way that one is. So I'm going to go back over here. I'm going to put a little more on that. And the thing is, you know, food is precious in general, But you, so in other words, you don't want to waste any, and you're not. I've never had too much. And of course, if you do have a lot of sauce on some on your kale, maybe you're doing one bunch to this whole thing. It's going to take longer the more sauce that you have on it, because of course it's wetter, right? So that's just the only thing to remember. But no big deal. No big deal. You know, you're on a spiritual level, you know I got to talk like this. Your hands hold the magic. Your hands are healing. So when you're using your hands to make your food, you're actually putting your mojo, your medicine, so it's healing you, and you're actually healing it. So it's something different. Your food tastes different when you're actually using your hand instead of utensils, because a lot of times even stainless steel kind of messes with the natural components of your kale or your food. So the best food I've ever had has been with my own hands, literally, right, with my own hands. So I think that is done or ready. Let me just get this one going. I think this kale is actually going to be better than my last batch, which I told my husband since we got to North Carolina, the last batch I made was the best I ever had here, because I had some good stuff in California as well. So, you know, it's about perfecting it, seeing what works for you. I mean, life is all about that, isn't it? So, we all know this. So, I don't want to waste, because this stuff is precious. So, I'm just going to get that in there, because it's all about the hands. And I'm sure if you don't feel comfortable, I mean, if you look on raw food recipes or raw food videos, most of them are using their hands. If you don't feel comfortable, I'm sure you can, you know, mix it with a spoon, okay? So there we have it. I'm going to show you the last thing that we're going to do. Look, y'all, I just cannot waste any. It's just too good to waste, and the chips love it. So, okay, so this is the last part to do, so I'm going to just wipe my hands. Now, normally, it's like the batter, you know, how you lick the batter. That's how good this tastes. When your mom made a cake. But I'll spare you that one. And we'll just get it on the tray. And in the oven, in this case, it's the dehydrating oven, right? So let me just show you, if you're not familiar with a dehydrator, I'll show you the actual oven itself. But these are the trays. So it comes with this here. And then you just get that in top so it can be in place. And all you do at this point is you want to kind of spread your kale out. Can you get me, can you see me more? Or should I move some? Okay. You want to spread your kale out, because that's going to help it to dry faster. So depending on, you know, we used to have a very small dehydrator called the starter dehydrator. And that dehydrator, everything took longer because it was small. And if you've made a lot, you have to take the other trays out. So I think this is a 9-tray dehydrator we have now. I think before it was a 5. So this is a 9. But even this one, the trays you're not using, that's why I don't make so many, you're going to take out of the dehydrator, because it's going to give you more air. That's why they cook so fast, because they're not competing with a lot of other. If I filled all 9, the kale wouldn't even fit in there. So it's important that we make sure that we give the kale some room to breathe, ladies, okay? Or gentlemen, because you might be watching this yourself. So I'm telling y'all, y'all going to be like, hallelujah. That's how good it is. And this is a great recipe. I'm going to keep this recipe for life. You might, like I said, my daughter loves it. My husband loves it. So here's one already done. Here's one already done. And so I noticed that one batch usually fills 2 trays, okay? So one batch fills 2 trays. So altogether we should have 4 trays, if my calculations are correct. And so, yeah, this is a fun way. I knew this one was going to take a little more time, but I also know it's worth it. And like I said, make it, do a batch, and then when that's finished, put more in. And, you know, you can take them to outings, have it for your picnics, take it to work as a snack. I mean, so much so many ways that you can have this. This could be your popcorn. This will get rid of all those folks like me that love chips, but no, chips don't love us. So if you're that person, hallelujah. No, holla. Let me know. Okay, so that's that. So those two are done. So what I would do is, of course, put those in dehydrator, and we're going to do that. But let's get this here, and let's do the same thing. Let's put that away. Okay, so we're going to do the same thing. We have our tray. And, yeah, and so, yeah, this really is a lovely, lovely meal. I'm always happy. All right, ladies, so we are continuing. We wanted to make sure that you could see everything, so we're going to just keep putting the kale on. And like you say, you see I'm just slightly separating them, just making sure they're not on top of each other. So, you know, be careful with that. But even if they are, they're going to dry. It's just going to take a little longer. And I just found that this is the best way to do it. So take your time. And, you know, like I said, this is another thing that your children can help you with. They would actually, I think, love it. And the good part is if you didn't dehydrate this, you could still eat it. So this could be a salad in itself, but the dehydration, I believe, brings out the true flavor of the kale. So let me just get that last one, okay? I think the dehydrator brings out the true flavor of the kale, and I really love that. So I'm just going to put this on. This is all going to fit. So you can actually just put it all on, and then we'll spread it out. And then we'll set the oven. And if you're not familiar with a dehydrator, you're going to get familiar because I'm going to show you. And, yeah, this is very nice. It's so nice making it with y'all because I feel like I'm even taking my time. I'm usually, you know, I like to move fast. So, but this is just making, this is going to make this so beautiful. So what I want to do is just even it out a bit since we have very little here and we have more there. So all I want to do is even it out. So this kale is going to really cook nicely, not cook, but you know, dry nicely because it has room. So yeah, so this is, as you see, and I'll show you all of them together, this is our kale. And so what we're going to do now is we're going to take this lovely kale and we're going to put it in the dehydrator. And so I will see you all at the dehydrator. All right, ladies. So I wanted to briefly go over and just show you the Excalibur dehydrator, just in case you're not familiar with it. And so this is, I think, they call it a 9-tray. So it's pretty big. And inside, we'll put the trays in. What I did first was I took all the extra trays out. So the other 5 trays, I took them out because I want all that air to just dry the chips that I have. And so that's what I did. I took those out. And let me show you, there's a lever on this side, which actually turns it on in the back. So there's a lever in the back. There's an on and off switch, basically. So basically what I'm going to do is, of course, turn it on. You notice that lights up. And so this is with my start and this is my stop. But right now I'm going to first set the temperature. So I want it to be at 115 degrees because with raw foods, the belief is, that's time. Here's the temperature. Okay, 115 degrees because the raw foodists believe that anything cooked over 118 means that you're not preserving the enzymes, and that's very important. So we're going to go with 115 degrees, and then we're going to do the time, and we're going to do it for 4 hours. So I'm just going to hold that. We're going to do that for 4 hours. I'm going to go for 5, and there we go, 5, and I'm going to check it in 4. Okay, stay tuned, because then we're going to put the trays in. I want to show you the door of the dehydrator, and we'll do that in a minute. All right, ladies, so what I'm going to do is I want to make sure that it's not touching the top, and I also want to make sure they're not touching each other, because when you first put the kale in, because it's still kale in its natural form, or its wet form, it's kind of thick. And so if you place too many on top of each other, what you'll find is that they kind of hit each other, and you don't really want that because you want that room in between. So right now, I'm thinking of that last one. So what I think I'm going to do is put that. I think this can still go up. No, so I'm not going to do that. I think I was good. I think I'm going to do it down here. Okay, yeah, that was good. And what I think I'll do here is I'll go down one more as well. And they're still great, not on top of each other, because I want to fit this fourth one in. And so we're going to do the fourth one, which is placed right here for it. So now we have room in between each one. And so let me show you the door. So this is the door of the Excalibur. And all you do is put it on. And I'm going to hit start. And it's going to go for 5 hours. I'm going to check it in 4. And once it's ready, we'll pull it out of the oven. And you'll see the final results. So I'll see you then. All right, ladies. So the kale is come out of the oven or the dehydrator. And so as you see, you can easily see that it really shrinks down to barely nothing. So what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to take the kale. And what I like to do is put them in a nice bowl, because I'm going to actually be eating them right now. The other thing that I do is I'll put them in a plastic Ziploc bag at night. So I'm going to continue to just put them in. They really are delicious, and they're very crunchy. And I'm sure you could actually kind of hear them. So they really do remind you of standard potato chips, just without the unhealthiness of it all. But I just wanted to put it in here because I really want to show you. And we can actually just put them in. I wanted to show you how much the 2 batches, 4 trays actually make. Now, keep in mind, I ate some, but I didn't eat a lot. And this is it. It's delicious, nutritious, packed with vitamins and minerals, and so wonderful for you, ladies. So this is a wonderful way to have a snack and not feel guilty. And those are the best kinds of snacks to me. Ladies, thank you so much for coming into my kitchen. And thank you so much for enjoying, and I know that you will, these wonderful, I call them pizza kale chips, raw and delicious. See you in the next segment. Peace and blessings. Peace and blessings. This is Lisa Marie Goodson of the Afrocentric Home Decor and Style Channel. And whatever came before this segment, I hope you enjoyed the wonderful, delicious, it is delicious once you try it, raw chips that I made. I call them pizza chip. I hope you love them. But today, or right now, I wanted to talk about color in our everyday style and fashion. We're going to talk about color, we're going to talk about fashion, and also keep in mind that we are outside. We have a beautiful river to our right. We have these beautiful green trees. And so really nature totally we're imitating nature every time we decide to wear something colorful. Every color that you could think of is in nature, whether it's the flowers, the trees, different grass, the sand. Go to different places, the sand is white sand, black sand, even the structures on a building, and even this beautiful brick represents the color. And as African people, we love color. We have always been into color because we understood that color was representative of many different things, whether it was the status of the queens and kings in Ghana that showed their royalty or their other status. So yeah, so color was used for to denote your status in the community, whether that was a chief, a queen, a drummer, dancers, wood carvers. We always use colors to tell about who we are. Colors also represent mood. You know, people ask me all the time, everywhere I go, they go, you know, oh my God, you wear such beautiful colors. You know, you always wear bright colors. Like, how do you have the courage or the nerve to do it? And my question would be to anybody that asked me that, no disrespect, of course, how do you have the courage not to do it? I mean, color is how, let me just tell you about me, how I get inspired. Let's talk about this outfit right here. So, I'm gonna tell you about the inspiration for this outfit, because color to me is definitely about inspiration. So a lot of times too, you know, another thing I love in Africa is a lot of times a married couple will actually dress in the same colors. The outfit itself might be different, but the colors are exactly the same to promote harmony and love. And so for me, my color choice is actually about feeling as well. So I knew today that I felt like I wanted to wear these pink tights, right? So what inspired that? So for me, it's a feeling, like why the pink? Okay, I love the bright color, but it also makes me feel like a feeling. It makes me feel very happy. It reminds me of being a child. Pink is a color of love. A lot of people think it's red, but red is for passion. Pink is for love. It makes me feel light on my feet and sassy and fun. So I wear my pink on a day when I want to be seen, but also I want to get things done. I want to move about. I want to have a joyous feeling. Yeah, so for me, yeah, so the idea is I wanted to wear the pink because I felt a feeling, or I wanted to feel a feeling, so I pulled out the pink. So the pink is my starting color, or in this case, it's my stocking. Sometimes I'm influenced by a particular jacket that I want to wear tomorrow, or a particular dress or skirt, or even my shoes, or even my bag. So I start with one piece, which is the pink tights. And then I think about, you know how most people think about now, what would match with the pink tights or that base color, whatever you're starting off, your inspiration is. I think about what wouldn't match. And better still, I think almost about, people think about what will go, I think about what won't go. You understand? How can I make it not go together? How can I make it not match? Some people like to say, it doesn't match, but it goes. And I like that a lot. So for me, when I look at this, I go, well, what am I feeling? What do I want? So when I think of the idea of this dress, so this was the second piece. After the pink tights, I built the dress. And so for me, and let me just move this mic, and then we'll go into the jacket. And okay, so for me, I thought about the dress. And I'll tell you what I thought about the dress, and that's the thing with these bracelets, which we're going to take them off, and we're going to talk about the accessories as well. So when I thought about the dress, I thought to myself that this dress, to me, I like the tulle that's on the bottom of the dress, right? So I love the tulle on the bottom of the dress. And I thought to myself, well, what shoes would really accentuate the tulle? And I thought more of this style. When I look at these red shoes, they're suede, I love the strap here. So I love this strap, and that strap almost reminds me of the straps of a ballerina shoe. So of a ballet shoe, because tulle is really known to kind of have that idea of a ballet outfit, a ballet dress. And I thought that that would be so nice with it. And then the pointy toe shoes always make a woman look taller, because I'm not very tall, I'm only 5'2". So it makes a woman look taller when the shoes are pointed. So this is what made me choose the shoes after choosing the dress. I chose the dress because I wanted to stay in the family of reds, and I feel like pink is a you know, kind of derivative of reds. So I wanted to stay into that love color, the love month of February and the whole bit. And so this is what influenced me with the dress. So this is how I got the dress. And then I thought, I don't want it two reds, two pinks, so I had to bring in some yellow. I think yellow breaks the color up, still brings in the vibrancy, but also, you know, it's not matchy-matchy. And so then, y'all know y'all want to know, well, what influenced the jacket? We got so many workers here. The jacket is actually from the designer, Nishona. Is her company name Nishona. Her name is Lillian. She's out of Goldsboro, North Carolina. And hold on, because I bet y'all don't hear me. She's out of Goldsboro, North Carolina. Her name is Nishona. And so this jacket, look at these puff sleeves. Every color that you could think of is in this jacket. So I thought to myself, what would pull in these beautiful necklaces with this? And I thought the jacket pulled in all of the colors. And I put this jacket on because it's a great example of that. When we think that this color doesn't go with that color and that pattern doesn't go with that pattern, look at this jacket and tell me if every color and pattern is in it and it all goes. And I love the detail in this. No, this is not that jacket. They all got different detail. This has the one button, no pockets, cinched at the waist. Love it. So of course, it was easy for me to think about the red bracelets, and it was easy for me to know that even if any of these bracelets, I mean rings that I chose orange, my favorite color, and the gold, because look at this. As you see, the orange picks up the orange in the bag, the orange ring, and the gold picks up the yellow as well. But if I turned it around, still got the red, got blues, got yellows. So this is why I really wanted this one, because I thought if we're going to go there with the color, then we need to go all the way there with the color. And so that's what we're doing here. And so this is me every day. Now let me just give you some examples, okay? Now what if you are just not ready to wear that much color in a day, or, you know, with one outfit? Easily you could do. You could easily pair the pink tights with a navy blue suit and go to work. Navy blue suit, navy blue shoes, white top, just a pop of color in the pink, be lovely. You can wear a total black suit, maybe a pantsuit with a jacket, and just carry the bag. And the rest of it is conservative. You can actually wear a conservative blouse, like a white ruffle blouse with a nice gray skirt, and let's bring in one of the necklaces or just the rings and still have the Afrocentric flair and color. You could actually wear a traditional, maybe a white outfit if you wanted to, maybe it's the spring, and bring in the color through your sandals or your pumps or your shoes, a red, a yellow, a green, a blue. So there's a lot of ways to be more colorful, and I'll tell you, y'all, it stops people stop on the street and everything. I tell my husband that I could dress anybody with what they have in their wardrobe right now to bring more color into their lives, and they wouldn't have to buy a new thing. It's just about, remember, it's not about what matches, it's about what goes. And if you think about that when you're getting dressed every day, you're really thinking more Afrocentrically. You know, I know as young folks, when I was growing up, we were always teased about not matching. Oh, you don't match, look at you don't match with all those colors. But in actuality, every color matches in a lot of ways, because in nature, you would never walk through a field of flowers, a variety of flowers, and say that it doesn't match. So the beauty that you admire in nature is the beauty you have to bring into your wardrobe to really be Afrocentric. Things that I find that happen, opportunities. People stop me on the street wanting to take pictures, asking me how do I wear more color, wanting to know how I can help them to do it as well. And y'all, the biggest reward of wearing all this color is I feel amazing every single day. It is a joy to get up knowing, thinking to myself, what am I going to wear? What outfit am I going to choose? What color? What jacket? It's exciting. Sometimes I stay up at night thinking about the outfit I'm going to wear tomorrow. Isn't that amazing? And so, yes, and you can also bring color in your hair, whether you dye it, color it, all many ways to keep yourself looking vibrantly beautiful. So if you want to know more about color, if you want to take a class on how to use color, I have a wonderful intensive. It's called Afrocentric Spiritual House Cleansing. And in it, for 21 days, even though it'll be recorded by the time you purchase it, you can have it and get a whole lesson for 21 days on the idea of Afrocentricing everything in your life. And I hope that you enjoy. And I'll see you all in the next segment. Peace and blessings. Peace and blessings. So our next segment is an interview with a dynamic young historian, black female. Her name is Sarah Blanchett, and she is the historian at Reed's Goldmine. What you're about to hear from her is definitely going to touch your heart. It's the story of Peter, who was an enslaved African, and he was one of an enslaved African who actually discovered one of the biggest gold nuggets to date. Unfortunately, there were, and I say unfortunately, a lot of enslaved Africans in the gold mining journey or business in North Carolina. A lot of people think that the gold rush, in a sense, kind of got its popularity in California, but in actuality, North Carolina was one of the first places that gold was discovered. And so Peter, this enslaved African, found this piece of gold nugget. A little bit about Sarah, and she'll tell you more herself. Sarah actually was born and raised in North Carolina and had, I'm sure, visited or known of Reed's Gold Mine. Unfortunately, Reed's Gold Mine would tell the story of mining from a white perspective, as if the miners were all white. And they had some very small blurb about Peter. And so Sarah thought this was unacceptable. And so she started to work there, and they offered her a job, and she started a black gold portion of the Reed Gold Mines display, where people, children come, schools, churches, everything, groups come to visit the gold mine. And she said, you know, we have to tell the story of Peter, and not just that, but tell the story of the enslaved Africans that died in the gold mines at the time. So the interview, and I call it an interview, but really it's not. The sister just gave it up, and we're so thankful for her. She's young, she's black, she's gifted, and she's powerful. And she is one of our historians, and we want to pay homage to just all that she knows. And so the interview you're about to see, the discussion, get ready. Take notes, have your tissues, release the let go, and enjoy the interview. Peace and blessings.
We got to ring 'em all day long, hammer ring. We got to ring 'em all day long, hammer ring. Oh well, I believe I'm double Johnny Boy, hammer ring. Oh well, I believe I'm double Johnny Boy, hammer ring. Oh well, I'm loaded from my ride on, hammer ring.
So 28 pounds, so gold is, the value of gold is determined by its weight.
Mm-hmm.
So I just looked this up this past weekend. Mm-hmm. Right now, 1 ounce of gold is worth $1,515.10. 16 ounces in a pound.
Right.
So 28 times 16 times, you know, it's probably a little bit more than $500,000 today.
Oh my gosh. Wow. Wow.
So that worth today, think of, you know, the equivalent back in the early 1800s, and the fact that the founder was not able to utilize that.
So when enslaved Africans were bought and sold,
yes,
was gold one of the means of exchange, or was there something, was there dollar bills
in before? This area? Not necessarily.
Okay.
This North Carolina was referred to as the Rip Van Winkle state, meaning it was very, very slow.
Okay.
So the way slavery kind of came to the Carolinas was due to the fact it was used as an incentive.
Okay.
The concessions of 1665 essentially suggested that if you move to the Carolinas by January 1st, then if you're a free man, free woman, or wife, then you'll get 100 acres.
Mm.
And if you bring with you indentured servant or an enslaved person who's 14 years and older, then you'll get an additional 50 acres, 75 acres.
Mm.
And so those concessions continued on to incentivize people populating the area, populating the Carolinas.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how slavery kind of made its presence a little bit known, and then of course population started to explode. And it wasn't until really the Constitution was created for the Carolinas that actually put down in the books officially that Carolina Africans were enslaved. So it was a matter of 4 or 5 years when that was put down in the books, and then legal slave codes weren't created until 1715 in North Carolina. And so though you have legally just establishing slavery, even though it's been part of society for hundreds of years. But here, you know, that not only makes it okay legally, having the laws changed so that it's genetically supported, having the laws changed so that it's supported by society, supported by money, supported by everything.
Right, right.
By the time John Reed comes here, it's so normal.
Right.
And he was a man of his time. By the time he died in 1845, he had 18 enslaved men, women, and children that he was able to pass on to several of his relatives when he died.
And where did Peter go? I mean, so Peter was owned by...
Peter was owned by Reverend Love.
Reverend
and
Love.
We don't know that much about Peter, naturally. Unfortunately, John Reed was illiterate, so he didn't, you know, write things down, which is really unfortunate. I wish people had the forethought of doing that. Reverend Love, haven't really done much research on him and his relationship with Peter. We don't really have that much information, mm-hmm. and that's unfortunate.
Right.
I do have contact with some of the current Black Reeds, mm-hmm. who are descendants of those free, okay. those who have been apprenticed, right. or who may have been enslaved. I'm trying to cultivate a relationship with them, yes. so I can learn their story and right. eventually add a significant part in our exhibit space on right. the Black Reeds and their experience here.
Absolutely.
But it takes work, and I'm the only person doing it.
Well, how did you get here? Like, this story of Peter, was this story always here?
Yeah.
Okay, but...
The story was always here.
Okay.
It wasn't until I got here
right.
that it was okay for that story to be told.
Oh, wow.
And I had my predecessor, he wanted to tell that story, mm-hmm. but he was denied because... for whatever reason.
Mm-hmm.
But
was he Black or?
He was white.
He's
white.
Yeah.
And he's a historian.
Yeah.
So he respects
right.
and wants to honor those who are on this land.
Right.
But he was told no, which is fine.
Right.
But it's unfortunate that it took someone who looked like the individuals that the story is being told
right.
about to tell the story.
Right.
And, you know, I told you the typical narrative of John yeah. Reed and Finding the Nugget and Conrad.
Right.
And then in all of our narrative that we tell regular folks,
right.
it's always one sentence. Peter found the largest
sure.
nugget.
Oh, yeah.
And
like
then
the
they move on.
Just like everything we've learned.
And
yeah.
I noticed that is very lacking.
Yeah.
That something needs to be researched
yeah.
more about.
Right.
Something needs to be told. And that's a part of history that
right.
no one really talks about.
Right.
Enslavement.
That's right.
It's a touchy subject,
yeah,
but
still
it's
here.
All of our history.
Yeah, all
and
ours,
if
yeah.
and I created the Black Gold North Carolina Slavery and Re-Gold Mine program
mm-hmm.
so that I can not only talk about it,
right.
but let people be aware of the fact that it happened right here.
Right here.
And the fact that we have a gold rush is
yes.
because of an enslaved man.
That's right.
And not only do we need to talk about the history, but we also need to be aware of how we talk about the history.
Exactly.
When we talk about slaves,
yes.
it's dehumanizing,
yeah.
it's demeaning,
mm-hmm.
and we're not giving them their due.
That's right.
So I tell everyone in my program that we need to start talking about how they are enslaved.
Yes.
How they're born
absolutely.
Free.
Born free.
Like
very
you and
important.
I.
Yes.
But based on the time period they're born
yes.
in, they're placed into the institution
yes.
of slavery.
That's right.
And if we start talking about it in that way,
right.
enslaved man, enslaved woman,
yes.
enslaved child.
That's right. We humanize them.
We humanize
absolutely.
Them. We give them that respect
right,
because
respect.
We're all here because of
you
them.
You better believe it.
And so, in changing our language, hopefully
yes.
we will be able to influence each other
yes.
to recognize that it's okay to talk about it.
It's okay to talk about it.
It's my history. It's your history. It's everyone's
it really
history.
Is. Yeah.
And so we shouldn't shy away from it. We
right.
should embrace it.
Exactly.
And we should embrace their history and their presence. So,
and how's that going? Like,
it's going really
yeah,
well.
Okay.
The first year, you know, people trickled in. But
mm.
Last year, I doubled the visitation, doubled the revenue
for
it.
You.
This year, I'm going to be matching last year, maybe a little bit more.
Good.
I'm finding more groups are actually booking Black History tours throughout the year instead of just
yes.
waiting until February.
That's wonderful.
And I'm constantly saying, hey, this is a part of the narrative. It's part
yes.
of the history.
Yes.
Don't just wait for Black History
that's
Month.
Right. That's very important.
Let's do this. So I've had groups in October.
Great.
I had a group on Thursday,
yes.
and they didn't just wait till Saturday when the program was.
Right.
They wanted a book in the middle of the month.
That's beautiful.
I have a group of 50 tomorrow.
Really?
And that's
wow.
outside of the program at 1.
Yes.
I have a group at 10 o'clock and
yes.
then I'm going to do the regular program at 1.
Good.
So I found that this is a history that people want to learn
of
about
course.
And it's wonderful to see. And I'm hoping next year I'll triple
I'm
everything.
Sure
white quartz.
Right, I do feel Peter for sure. White quartz. So this is what this rock is.
Yeah. Right. And so if you kind of look at it, you don't really see any of the like gold
wow,
lines through it,
no.
but you'd have to.
But I definitely see it a piece of like crystal.
Yeah.
Right? Wow.
So it has the properties that you want. The white quartz is what you want
wow.
when you're looking for gold.
Wow.
Isn't this place amazing?
It is.
I just had an email from someone asking about because the Reed Cemetery is on the property.
Right.
She asked about if there's any archives or any footage or any oral history about
right.
enslaved people being buried there.
Yeah.
And there are maybe like 9 to 13 stones that are in the ground that are separated from the family. Mm-hmm. We don't know who they belong to. But, you know, wow. You have those stones. And I told her, you know, we don't know.
Right.
There hasn't been any supporting that fact or right. negating that fact.
Right.
But I can do research for you and see what I find yeah. because African-American narrative is important and I'm right. in touch with the Black Reads and I'm trying yes. to get this exhibit, hopefully. Right. And she emailed back and she said, you just made me cry
yeah.
because I'm a descendant of wow. one of Reed's children.
Oh my gosh.
And so I'm a white woman.
Wow.
And I love the fact that this story is being told.
Wow.
And I was like, wow, I made her cry just yeah. from being honest.
Honest. Like, yeah.
That's cool.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
And I have so many people who call and say, hey, we went to your program. It was wonderful. Thank you for the book recommendations.
Right.
Thank you for talking to my group and not dumbing anything down, but being a little conscious of age group.
Yes. Mm.
So
definitely.
It's whatever's happening, it's working.
Right. So who would benefit? I mean, obviously everyone, but I'm going to ask this question anyway, because we want people
yeah.
to actually come down and make this. I mean, is this like, I know, what do you call the society? It's like the Chamber of Commerce. Is this something that's where you can go to and find out what to do in North Carolina historically?
There
is. This is a historic site.
This is a state historic site.
Okay.
So if you go to our website,
okay.
if you go to the North Carolina Department of Natural Cultural Resources website, if you go to all of our social media, Twitter, Facebook, we update constantly.
Yeah.
Call our number, 704-721-4653.
Good.
Ask for a group, which is 10 or more, and to schedule for Black History Tour.
That's good, because I wanted to ask you how we can specifically support.
$2 a ticket for anyone 8 and older.
Wonderful.
Yeah, and so I purposefully made it that cheap
wow.
because some of the higher-ups are like, no, you should make it free. I'm like, no, if people are coming to this program,
yes.
they're wanting to come
yes.
to the program.
That's right.
And no one will balk at a $2
that's right.
ticket.
That's wonderful.
And that's just for a 45-minute
right.
presentation, discussion, talk with me,
right.
and then a optional tour.
Wonderful.
And I take them underground. If I'm able to, if it's too big, then
right.
I'll have my part-time staff take them through. But I'll meet them at the top, and then we can walk all the way down, and I end with Peter.
Let's go. You want to go? You want to go underground? I know
yeah.
you do.
So,
I'm sure we have to do it. And so, children groups are. Is it children's groups? Is it church groups? Like what?
Everyone.
Everybody.
It's multi-generational.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Last year I had a Boy Scout group.
Yes.
And there was zero brown people in that group.
Really?
And they asked really good questions
right.
and they're really interactive
yeah.
because I don't like talking at people.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Like I want to discuss things
yes.
with you.
Mm-hmm.
I ask
yes.
you questions. Mm-hmm. You can ask me questions.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Let's make this, you know, not me with all of my knowledge
right.
telling you things.
That's mm-hmm. right.
I want to know
that's
what you
right.
know as well.
That's
and I always
right.
start off with asking, well, when you think of slavery, what do you think of?
Yeah,
and
good.
People think of, you know, Gone with the Wind,
oh,
and they
wow.
think of cotton.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
imagine.
Well, that's
sure.
true. But
yeah.
I'm going to talk to you about how slavery came to North Carolina. I'm going to talk
yes.
to you about slavery in the 1600s
yeah.
and in the 1700s.
Right.
We're going to talk about tobacco.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
We're talking about way before King Cotton. We're
right.
talking about way before, you know, Django Unchained.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And I try to make, you know, give them context
right.
and tear down their present thinking
yeah.
of slavery.
Yes,
build
right.
them back up.
Yeah.
To the context of which John Reed lived in.
Yes.
Try to compare it, you know, as horrible as it is to own another person,
right.
it's like owning a car for us today.
Yeah,
it's all about
right.
status. The
yeah.
better the car,
right.
the more money you
mm-hmm.
make, the higher in society you are.
Mm-hmm.
That's how it was for people. And so if you think about, you know, your lower class people and they
right.
have one enslaved person,
yeah.
well, they're a little bit higher in society than that other family over
right.
there who doesn't
right.
have any
that's
money
right.
to own any
right.
enslaved
gotcha.
People.
Mm-hmm.
And so I try to tell them, you know, this is how slavery came to North Carolina.
Right.
And why did they choose Africans? Why
mm-hmm.
didn't they choose white people or
mm-hmm.
Native Americans?
Mm-hmm.
And I explain that they died a lot.
Right.
Native Americans, this was their land.
That's
so
right.
they knew how to escape and live off the
exactly.
land.
Makes
they
sense.
Would die from those European diseases.
Right. Right.
White people, most of them were indentured servants. If they had to work for someone, when they were done with their indentured servitude, when they were
yeah.
done with their contract, they could live and be off and be free.
Right, exactly.
And so Africans who didn't die as often,
right.
who knew how to be agriculturally
yeah.
sound with working the land,
oh, yeah.
and who were physically strong,
right.
they and physically looked different
yes.
and were separated from their own countries,
yeah.
They were the logical choice.
Exactly.
And so I take them through that and then say, yes, Conrad found the nugget, but let's talk about Peter.
Right.
And then talk about what enslaved people and free people would be doing in the mining industry.
Right.
Because that's something we don't talk about
right.
either.
Right. And I was going to ask you that. So how was it dangerous? Because I keep thinking of like South Africa and the whole idea of mining.
Yeah.
What's the difference?
Of course. Well, the difference is in the Carolinas, mm-hmm. farming was the number one job.
Mm-hmm.
Gold mining, prospecting, that was something that eventually overtook that.
Mm-hmm.
But this was more of a hobby.
Okay.
So you have your enslaved people, of course, working the land.
Mm-hmm.
If they have a value or a skill as a carpenter or a blacksmith,
mm-hmm.
then that would, of course, increase their own value.
Right.
And you have, of course, them taking care of the land,
mm-hmm.
planting, harvesting,
mm-hmm.
raising the land, cutting down trees,
mm-hmm.
fixing fences,
mm-hmm.
fixing tools, taking care of children,
right.
Taking care of each other. I don't think there was that much movement
right.
just because your closest neighbor is 5 miles away.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And so those legal codes, those
mm-hmm.
slave patrols, those
mm-hmm.
Laws that slowly start to control
mm-hmm.
the African American population
right.
is not as enforced
right.
here.
Right. Okay.
And so that's how you have the, you know, the master of the land being judge and jury
mm-hmm.
and those punishments. If this one doesn't work, then let me try this one. This one seems to work.
Mm-hmm.
So then you have that slow evolution
mm-hmm.
of the sadism of those punishments
mm-hmm.
in the 19th century
mm-hmm.
because everything was a crapshoot, essentially.
Wow.
So with enslaved people, of course, they'd be working the land, but they'd also be panning the creek. They'd
right.
be digging around. And then you have, of course, gold being an industry in and of itself.
Mm-hmm.
So for those individuals who kind of want to rent someone,
mm-hmm.
you could rent an enslaved person
mm-hmm.
if you talk to that master,
mm-hmm.
$150, $175,
mm-hmm.
depending on the individual,
wow.
of course.
Mm.
John Reed. Not sure if he did that or not,
right.
but there were those individuals who did it. There
mm-hmm.
were those individuals who didn't want to
mm-hmm.
because you have those people just like today who want to make a quick buck
mm-hmm.
and they don't make sure that there's any safety.
Right.
So you have people, let's say we're going to dig and create a tunnel right here
right.
to go underground.
Yeah.
If I don't have the architectural knowledge,
right.
if I don't make sure that it's safe,
yeah.
then I say, hey, enslaved person that I just rented, go dig and
wow.
just keep going until you find me some gold.
My gosh.
Cave-ins, explosions,
wow.
any malnutrition,
right.
all of these things happened, of course.
Right.
And if that happened, then that individual who rented that enslaved person
right.
would, of course, have to pay the owner the value.
Wow.
And, of course, if that enslaved person is insured, then that owner gets that payoff anyway from the insurance
wow.
company. So it's fascinating.
Yeah.
And then you have places like Gold Hill
mm.
who would have African Americans work.
Mm-hmm.
If they're free, then that's great. That's wonderful. They'll get their money and
right.
they can go home.
Right.
In the 1800s, North Carolina workers were paid 30% below the U.S. average.
Wow.
So, of course, think of those free African Americans and
yeah,
how much they would be
exactly,
paid.
Right, right, exactly.
But if you're trying to get your freedom, you wouldn't have a lot of free people around you. Because
yeah.
if you're a free African American, then you would have at least 6 months before you have to leave the area.
Mm.
Don't want to encourage those
right.
enslaved people to you know,
right.
rebel
exactly.
or incite
yeah.
You know, delusions of grandeur.
Right.
So,
exactly.
You know, they would work, they might go off back home, or
mm-hmm.
they'd go where they need to go.
Mm-hmm.
If you find any gold around, what better way to make sure that it's going to be yours but by hiding it?
Right.
Natural hair, you take mm. those tiny little nuggets, you hide it in your hair,
mm-hmm.
you find a place that you know no one's gonna find,
mm-hmm.
dig a little hole,
right.
bury it, go
yeah.
back to it later.
Yeah.
And for these individuals,
mm-hmm.
not necessarily able to buy their freedom, depending on, of course, the
right.
ownership and that individual. But some were able to buy their freedom. Right. Some used that gold, barter and trade.
Yeah.
You have these little communities that mm-hmm. pop up. They're called boom towns. Mm-hmm, that's mm-hmm. what Charlotte actually was.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You hear about gold, you come, yeah, create a little sense. Town. Mm-hmm. You have women mm-hmm. coming, following their husbands. Mm-hmm. They become domestic goddesses. Mm-hmm. You earn money that way by education, by teaching, mm-hmm. by doing the laundry, mm-hmm. by taking care of someone's kids, mm-hmm. by cooking, whatever.
Right.
And while they, and sometimes you can be out in the creek mm-hmm. panning or using other, you know, machines to find gold, they
right.
could be paid that way.
Right.
You have African Americans who yeah, have, right. you know, little bits of gold. Like, okay you have some whiskey. Mm-hmm. I have this little nugget of gold. Let's
mm-hmm.
do a trade.
Mm-hmm.
Tobacco,
right.
Payment for those jobs that I just said.
Yeah,
you
really.
Know, that's a way they would be able to use that gold right. if they couldn't purchase their freedom.
So they understood the value of gold.
Yeah, they understood the value of gold, even if, you know, maybe 50 years prior,
right.
Peter, who understood that value of gold as well, you know, they understand
right.
the value, but they also understand the reality
yeah,
of
the reality,
their situation.
Exactly. Like
yeah.
the fork story that
yeah.
you told, which is really true.
Yeah.
Did you find or did you research any people passing maybe gold from one generation to the next, just as something to, like an heirloom?
I haven't.
Yeah.
So that would be fascinating
yeah,
to find.
I wonder. I bet we did.
Yeah.
I'm just thinking how black folks would think, because yeah. there was these objects
were
that
were very tangible.
Exactly. Exactly.
And everything has a meaning.
Yes.
And, or a symbolism
there
to
you
it.
Go. Exactly. That's
so,
how I see it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Especially so, since it wasn't necessarily a value to us in the sense that it was
right.
going to buy our freedom.
No, but it could be a representative of
go.
This is where we've
this
come
is
from,
where
this is
we
how
come.
Hard we've
got
worked
it. Yeah.
for,
yeah.
and
you
we didn't
totally
let
see.
This, you know,
you
control us.
That's right.
We rose above it.
Yeah.
That kind of, yeah, I could totally see
yeah.
that happening.
Me too.
Yeah.
Me too. And you talked a little bit about tobacco. Was tobacco before cotton? Was it the
tobacco
crop?
Was before cotton.
Did not know that
yeah.
one.
Yeah. Tobacco, so John Reed, he was a farmer.
Mm-hmm.
He was not a plantation owner
okay.
like Thomas Jefferson, George Washington.
Okay.
And the difference is plantation, you own acres and acres of land mm-hmm. and you only have one thing planted that's going to make you money.
Makes
tobacco,
sense. Right.
cotton, corn,
gotcha.
Rice,
okay.
indigo.
Right.
You have all of that, acres and acres and acres.
Okay.
And that's your cash crop.
Yeah.
That's what you're going to have your enslaved people harvest and know, take care of the land,
right.
rotate different
yeah.
acreage
yeah.
to make that money
gotcha.
For you. That's a plantation.
Mm-hmm.
So Thomas Jefferson, George Washington.
Mm-hmm.
John Reed was a farmer.
Okay.
So he grew enough to not only make money, but also to live off of.
Mm-hmm.
So a little bit of cotton, a little bit
gotcha.
Of tobacco,
mm-hmm.
some fruit trees, making
mm-hmm.
cider and jam,
mm-hmm.
you know, a little bit of everything
mm-hmm.
for his family.
Mm-hmm.
So,
and
that
so he
is
had
the
enslaved
difference.
Africans as well. So farmers had enslaved Africans as well as plantations, but was this
yeah.
a smaller amount, or are they, were they really big farms?
Well, there were big farms.
Mm-hmm.
I think that for anyone in this area, it was all about status,
mm-hmm.
and John Reed was a very wealthy man
okay.
in comparison to some of his other neighbors, most
mm-hmm.
likely.
Mm-hmm.
So having 18 enslaved men, women, and children
wow,
at the
yeah.
time he died,
mm-hmm.
you know, he was pretty the top of society, and he probably
yeah.
could have gone into politics and such, but he
right.
really didn't care about that kind of stuff.
Right.
He was living the American dream.
Right.
So why is he going to
yeah.
mess that up.
Right.
Go with the status quo.
Right.
So he had all these enslaved people and, you know, they probably worked the land, helped
mm-hmm.
his wife in the house,
mm-hmm.
cared for everything.
Right.
And when he died, they were passed on to different, in his will,
right.
he gave one woman to his wife
mm-hmm.
and he, which was, I don't know what actually happened to her because his wife actually died before John Reed.
Oh.
But in his will, one African American was given to his wife,
mm-hmm.
and then the rest were given to his children and kind of put on
mm.
the market
mm.
with the rest of his estate.
Yeah.
mm. So did they actually, when you say the market, my mom, did they actually have auction blocks here at that time? Right?
No, not
it wasn't like that.
Not here.
Not here. So you kind of make a deal with your another colleague, so to speak.
Yeah.
About, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow.
It's like I'm not going to officially, you know, take my car to CarMax.
Right, right.
I know
right.
a relative
yeah.
who can use this exactly. car, mm. so I'll just.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's.
Isn't that
beautiful
wild?
And yeah, it's fascinating.
It is.
And it's amazing. So would you say, and you don't have to say if you want to
I'll say.
Okay. Would you say that if we look at some of the wealthier families here, because mm-hmm. they have names, we know that there's wealthy named families, would it be most likely that they gained their wealth through generations from some type of enslavement of Africans?
Yeah.
Yeah. In the South?
Yeah.
Yeah. Because, I mean, what other way was there to really make
To make money
and be wealthy for whites in the South because they were after the natives?
If they were educated,
okay.
then, you know, doctor, lawyer,
okay.
kind of like today, though I don't think they would go into that as massive debt as you would today.
Right, exactly.
But doctors, lawyers, if you're, if you own many, many, many acres of land, because land was the thing that
right.
denoted wealth.
Wealth, yeah.
But other than that, lawyers and doctors were pretty much the cream of the crop
right.
back in the day if you
yeah.
didn't own lots of land.
Right.
Just think about, like, Alexander Hamilton, he was a lawyer.
Mm-hmm.
Also going into the armed forces
mm-hmm.
kind of helped gave you a leg up because
right.
you were able to rub elbows with a lot of people who are wealthy.
Right.
You also were able to... find those individuals who were wealthy who may have someone go in their stead.
Mm-hmm.
You might, you know, have a relationship or conversation with that individual
mm-hmm.
and they're like, hey, the person who I'm actually here for,
right.
They might hook you up.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
yeah. But I would bet that any of the wealthier families
mm-hmm.
Had a leg up because of enslavement.
Mm-hmm. Wow. And how do you find, because I know a lot of different people from multi-ethnicities come here,
mm-hmm.
how do you find that, do you find the reaction that black people have to slavery or the story of slavery or being enslaved Africans, is it different than maybe some of the other ethnicities? And the reason why I ask is I know I remember in, you know, grade school,
mm-hmm.
that little two, three sentences about we were slaves
mm-hmm.
and how all of us, the black kids, we would kind of like, you know, crouch down in our,
yeah.
in our chairs. Because it was like, I don't know, we were embarrassed or there was so
right.
much. Do you find that black folks talk about slavery in the South?
I feel that African Americans talk about slavery in polite conversation
mm-hmm.
and addressing themselves as African Americans, making it a little bit more PC
mm-hmm.
and comfortable.
Mm-hmm.
But behind closed doors, they take their masks
yeah,
off.
Yeah, I understand that.
And they're
right.
just...
Blah, blah. Exactly, right.
When I yeah. talk about it, I purposely say that it's our history. Let's
yes.
talk about it.
Right.
I am not aggressive.
Right.
I use a lot of humor
yes.
to kind of make this space comfortable and safe.
Mm-hmm.
And I pause a lot
mm-hmm.
and I say, can you imagine? Or isn't that amazing to
right.
think of? And
yeah.
I do a lot of comparisons so
Good.
That they understand, okay,
right.
owning an enslaved person was normal back then.
Right.
It was like me owning a car now.
Exactly.
And talking to them about how, you know, you could have 30 people in a house and you wake up the next day and there might be 30 people still, but
wow.
they're different people
yeah, wow.
because someone could come down and take a child out or
That's
a man
right.
or a woman.
Yeah.
And I tell them, you know, African Americans, enslaved people, they were used to cover taxes and
mm-hmm.
gambling debts.
Mm.
And children were used as Christmas gifts and
wow.
wedding gifts
mm.
and just give them that idea.
Yes.
And I think what helps me talk about that is that I was an interpreter at Colonial Williamsburg.
Mm.
So I donned the clothes.
Mm-hmm.
I looked the part.
Yes.
I had lead tours in
wow.
the house where there were the most enslaved people.
Oh my
gosh. And I constantly went against what Colonial Williamsburg wanted, which
yeah.
was to be in the time period in which you're talking about,
right,
and I
exactly.
constantly wanted to step outside and
yeah.
say, listen, I'm Sarah
right.
in 2000 and whatever.
That's right.
I want to have a conversation
That's
with you.
Right, Sarah.
I don't want to go back into the 1780s
yeah.
and
right.
pretend
yeah.
that Peyton Randolph died and we don't know how the enslaved people are reacting.
Right.
But let's talk about that.
Yes.
No, I want to have a conversation with
yeah.
you. I want to recommend books to
That's
you.
That's right.
I want to tell you that, yes, I am actually educated in this.
Yes.
So you shouldn't question me too much,
That's
but
right.
you should question.
Exactly. Yeah.
So,
it's like a sister we know.
Yeah. Yeah.
Good.
How do you feel? I mean,
yeah,
are you touched?
Because I'm talking about touch.
And how do you stay so calm?
Right.
I mean,
because
when you're...
But I hear her passion.
Yeah.
Yeah, I love history.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I come from it from a place where I was that kid in eighth grade who hated history because I didn't see myself in it.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't see any sort of representation other than
right.
your people were enslaved.
Right.
I knew there
exactly.
was more to the story than
yes.
that.
Go ahead.
And so it was a class trip to Colonial Williamsburg
mm-hmm.
where I'm like, okay, I can actually be in the space
right.
and kind of get the vibe
yeah.
of the place. And I
yeah.
thought that was pretty cool.
Yeah.
And then it wasn't until college when I could actually control what I learned a
yeah.
little bit
yeah.
and actually started taking African American history classes.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, okay, not only am I soaking up all of this information,
right.
It almost felt like, I'm not saying I didn't study because I did, but
right.
I almost felt like I didn't have to
yeah,
because
yeah.
it was just coming out.
It was coming
of
out.
Me.
Yeah, I could feel it.
Yeah.
Totally, cause I could
and so I was like, that's so cool.
Yeah.
Like maybe I can make a career out
yes.
of this.
Mm-hmm.
And
Talk
so I decided to go get my master's degree in
mm-hmm.
history because I knew I wanted to work in museums.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, okay, I want to make Black history
mm-hmm.
as acceptable
yes.
and as tangible.
Right.
For a little Sarah.
Yes.
Because I didn't have that.
Mm-hmm.
And so I want to make, wherever I go, whatever museums I go to,
right.
I want to make a space where it is okay to talk about certain things.
Yes.
And so I got my master's degree
mm-hmm.
in history
mm-hmm.
and I looked for places and I found Colonial Williamsburg.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, that's cool. I can go back to the place where it all started.
Right, right. Mm-hmm.
And I worked there for a year
mm-hmm.
and it was
yeah.
short.
I'm sure.
A year. Now it felt short, but
mm.
in that experience, it felt so long.
Oh my
mm.
gosh.
Because every day I'm putting on the stockings and I'm
mm.
putting on the petticoats and
right.
I'm putting on the gowns
mm.
and the head wrap
mm.
and I'm going to the house
mm.
or I'm going to the plantation site
wow.
and I'm hearing,
yeah.
I'm doing,
mm-hmm.
and I'm having conversations with really interesting people,
mm-hmm.
but I'm also having conversations with really interesting people.
Yes, mm-hmm. I understand.
And I'm getting, aren't you supposed to be carrying a bucket?
Wow.
Or, you know, they don't let Black people in the house, don't
wow.
you? And I'm getting that negative side.
Wow.
And so every day I would go home and just shower the day
yes.
off. And I wouldn't want to talk to anyone.
Right.
And it got to the point where it was too taxing.
Yeah, it was affecting you, of course.
It was affecting my voice.
Yeah.
It was affecting my passion and how I related to people
yes.
who would just come.
Right.
And hearing it from people, like, we just want to look at the furniture.
Yeah, basically,
we don't really want to learn about Black people in
right.
this space.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was like, oh,
yeah.
Well, that shut me up. Like, well,
right.
what's the point of me being here
right.
if people who are here don't want to learn?
Exactly.
And so I had to come back home
yeah.
and I had to recharge a bit.
Of course.
And then I started, you know, interning here
mm-hmm.
and interning there.
Mm-hmm.
And then I found this place. And
mm-hmm.
I'm like, okay, how am I going to make my mark?
Yeah.
On a place where I pass by 3 Confederate flags
yeah.
a day.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. We saw.
Yeah. Like, how am I going to make my mark
right.
on this place?
Yeah.
And so, you know, 6 months, I kind of learned the area,
mm-hmm.
learned the history,
mm-hmm.
kind of see where I could shake things up a bit. And
mm-hmm.
luckily, I had a great colleague to work with. And he's like, I want to shake things up with you.
Yes.
I want to do these things with you.
Beautiful.
And he is the most country-looking white boy I've ever seen
right,
in my life.
Right.
But I'm like, yes, I
yes.
can do this with you. We're going to
yes.
be good counterparts.
This is beautiful.
And so I went to my boss and I said, hey, I want to make a Black History program for Black History Month. And he's like, okay.
Really?
So
cool.
The support was lackadaisical.
Right.
It's like, whatever. And so I did it for the first year.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, all right.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Like, well, we had, you know, X amount of more people
yes.
in February than we ever did.
Yes.
And I'm like, okay, next year I got to do better.
Right.
I got to, you know, go out there and do more community outreach
right.
and start talking about this.
Yes.
And that's how we found ourselves
yes.
to introduce ourselves
so
at that, have that moment
exactly.
at the kickoff.
Yes.
And, you know, we have so many people who are interested in
right.
it and, you know, we advertise and we're like,
yeah.
please come learn this history. Yeah. And every time someone comes to the program, I say thank you for being interested.
Exactly.
Because it's not something to be ashamed of.
Right.
And I think the ideology and the racism and prejudice that we have are still experiencing today stems back from what I'm talking about.
Yes.
These things that are being put into place that's separating.
Absolutely.
And that is purposefully, psychologically creating a superior, inferior idea so that when you were in school, having that crouch down in the desk, that is hundreds of years of psychological abuse.
Absolutely.
And so I want to eviscerate that and have us rise above that and just talk about it. It's history. History's great and history's horrible.
That's right.
But it's a reality.
It's a reality.
We need to talk about
it. We really do.
Yeah.
Wow.
And so,
you're really changing lives. I mean, you probably don't know how many people have walked in.
Yeah.
Young, old, and in between.
I have no idea.
No, you don't, but because I'm changed. So I think you're changed, too.
I feel a whole different way.
Yeah, and I love that people come on site and they're changed and they go home. And I said, do research.
Yeah.
I give them my card. I'm like, email me. I will send you books from my personal library, the titles.
Right.
I'll look through and
send you. Can you share with our audience some of the books that
To learn about the colonial period, especially the legal process, I enjoy In the Matter of Race by A. Leon Higginbotham Jr. And then if you want to learn about Virginia and the ideas of race and power and gender, one of my favorite books is by Kathleen Brown, and it's called the title just passed by.
It's okay, it's coming back.
It's slowly come back. I gotta look it up now.
That's good. Yeah, because I know it's too much in my head.
Yeah, and that's the issue. I have so much in my head.
I'm sure. Kathleen Brown.
Kathleen Brown. I have the last part of the title. I don't remember the first part. Good Wives, Nasty Wenches, and Anxious Patriarchs.
God,
and that talks
title.
About gender, race, and power in colonial Virginia.
Wow.
Yeah.
And anything in North Carolina specifically should we know about? Gold-wise?
Gold-wise, well, in our gift shop.
There's
a book called Gold in North Carolina.
Okay.
We have several that talks about the geology and the history of North Carolina.
Right.
Off the top of my head, I can't remember their titles.
That's fine. But,
they are in our gift shop.
Yeah.
Honestly, email me, sarah.blanchette@ncdcr.gov. I will send you some good recommendations.
This is great.
Yeah.
Spell your last name.
B-L-A-N-C-H-E-T-T.
Yeah. Love it.
Like the actress Kate.
Right.
When people ask me, oh, are you related? I say, her people probably owned mine.
Yeah, really. You really want to know. I mean, it's just that simple.
Yeah.
I mean, really. Wow. I mean, I got so many questions. So.
Have at it.
Let me ask you this about North Carolina.
Answer. Yeah.
Because I know, you talked about this idea of kind of like the sleepy state. This kind of laid, lackadaisical.
Yeah.
And compare that to Alabama. Compare that to Mississippi. Even in slavery-wise, was it different? Is there such thing as there was some states that were crueler when it comes to slavery? Or what did you think about this idea of comparison as far as enslavement in particular states?
Enslavement in certain states were definitely, it was definitely harsher just because of the different types of crops there were.
Oh,
like in South Carolina, they have indigo, which is a really difficult process that involves, it is a little dangerous. And I honestly don't know the particulars, but it is a little dangerous in comparison to tobacco, where all you really have to do in tobacco is grow the plant, make sure there aren't any horn rim worms that are on the leaves eating away at them. And then at a certain time, you top the plant and it keeps growing.
Okay.
And then you take the plant, you take it out of the ground, you cut it, you slice it in half, and then you make what's called hands, where you have essentially planks of wood, and you just put it on there, split part, and you create hands, and then you put them in the tobacco barn, and let them dry, then you pack them into a huge barrel called a hogshead, and for a good crop, six hogshead barrels would be the ideal. And each of them holds like 1,000 pounds.
Wow. And that was more prevalent tobacco drying tobacco handling was more prevalent in the Carolinas or North
Carolina?
In the
Carolinas, in Virginia. Okay. And yes, a little in South Carolina. Mm-hmm. However, South Carolina was more rice. More cotton.
Cotton, for sure.
Indigo as well.
Indigo
and
as well.
The enslavement, honestly, you have the port of Charleston. You have those who are wealthy, who are considered, you know, gentlemen of good standing in society, who are from the upper echelons of Georgia.
Right.
You have these individuals who have their sprawling plantations, and like I said, they have neighbors who might be 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 miles, and so they hire people to police the African-American population, and so any sort of creativity, I mean, if you remember Roots and Kunta Kinte getting his foot chopped off, I mean, that was just creative.
Wow.
That's an incentive. Look what I did to someone who tried to run away.
Right.
That'll happen to you.
Mm-hmm.
If children, you know, did something wrong, then what better way to psychologically mess with the parents than, all right, child, you did something wrong, you didn't listen, so I'm going to whip the heck out of your mom.
Right.
Or I'm going to sell your father off just because of something you did. Now you better act right.
Yeah.
So all punishments really were incentives to keep control of the population.
Right.
How creative they were depended on the individual.
Gotcha.
And I think really society. If you've ever watched Underground, which is a fantastic show, which unfortunately was only 2 seasons, but one of the characters has 3 children, and they're all pretty light in color, and that's because they are all fathered by her owner, and he was running for a position in office, and his son essentially ran away, and they got him, and in order for him to make a point with all of the men that he needed to support him, he not only was, you know, doing a speech with these gentlemen, underneath him, underneath the, because he was on it like a deck, so underneath the deck was his own son hanging.
Oh my God.
To make a point that, you know, I am for enslavement, and he had property, he had enslaved men, women, and children, but, you know, to get their vote, you know, I'm gonna be as sadistic as them, because he was a little waffly, if you will.
And
so, so that creativity, like, it was supported. So I'm sure that there are pockets in society that were a lot harsher in punishments in Mississippi, Alabama, and you kind of see that mentality still hanging around because how many African Americans purposefully go into Mississippi and Alabama unless they live there? Think about everything that is going on now. There's a trail.
It has to be.
It leads all the way back.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
we do.
So I would say here in the Carolinas, Raleigh, where there's Duke Homestead, they had tobacco plantation. I'm sure the enslavement there was just a little bit harsher than good old Cabarrus County out in the country, where, you know, everything's kind of a little slower.
And how many acres is this particular site right here?
880.
Oh my God.
Wow.
Yeah, so we only utilize probably about 5 to 10%.
Right.
And we have 2.5 to 3.5 miles worth of hiking trails, walking trails.
Okay.
Open
to the public?
Yes.
Okay.
People are able to bring their dogs, you know, walk them along the trail. They can't go inside the visitor center or any of the buildings or the mine, but they can come out here. We have several people who just park and walk.
Okay, so yeah, people visit the park.
We have 17 picnic benches, so people can bring a snack or a lunch and or a blanket and enjoy themselves for the day.
Wow. And what is the population? What's the demographics of the folks here? Are they... There's a lot of African Americans here, lots of families, children, and different.
Lots of families, lots of children. We get a lot of school groups as well.
And they're local to the area.
Some are local to the area, some are travel from as far as South Carolina.
Oh, wow. Didn't know that. Okay.
Yeah.
That's cool.
And people mainly come because they want to pan for gold. Again, in April, we have our panning area set up so that people purchase a ticket for $3.21.
Wow.
They go to the panning area, exchange that ticket for a pan that is filled with dirt that we get right from our creek. And then we give you the skills and we interpret to you a little. and hopefully whatever you find at the bottom of your pan is worth
So you get to keep it.
Give you a little vial.
Is it successful? How or
we say about 1 in 10 find something.
That's so cool. You could be the one, Warren.
Yeah.
That is so cool. I wonder about that.
This so is it's, so it's cool. Pretty excellent. And
yeah.
You know, you could be here for a good 2.5-3 hours.
Oh, easy.
Just walking around.
Right.
Going on tour.
Wow.
Have you ever panned yourself?
I have. I have a little vial of gold in my office.
Yeah.
That is not full at all, but it's taken random days out in the creek panning.
Right.
It's got gold in it.
Yeah.
It doesn't look like gold because gold's raw, unrefined.
Yeah.
Is the color of gold, but it has more of a greenish brown tint to it.
Oh, good. So we would love to see some to show them, because that's a good thing. I mean, I don't think people really know.
No, I've never seen raw gold.
In jewelry.
Yeah, the bright. Right. Yeah. Shiny gold that's refined, that is polished.
Right.
The raw stuff is a little bit darker.
Wow.
But a lot of people don't realize that gold is everywhere.
Yeah,
gold is everywhere in land.
Right.
It's in your cell phones. It's in your camera.
How much is being used? Okay.
Yeah, and I believe the gold medals in the current Olympics.
Right.
The gold was used from donated cell phones and laptops.
Oh,
and
so they can extract the gold from that out of the
You take it out of the circuitry.
Well, load it from a ride on
hammering.
Well, they call me John Henry Boy.
Hammering.
Well, they call me John Henry Boy.
Hammering.
Well, don't you be scared, boy.
Hammering.
Well, don't you be scared, boy.
Hammering.
Nothing but my hammer, boy.
Hammering.
Oh, well, nothing but my hammer.
Yeah, we are.
We are about to walk into where our ancestors, this would have been, take us back hundreds of years ago. What did this look like?
This would have actually been not as shored up as this.
Right.
This would have been one of the tunnels, but you actually might not have even, this all would have been caved in.
Wow.
This wasn't actually the actual entrance for Reed Gold Mine.
Uh-huh.
Tunnels were rarely the actual entrance. They used shafts, which are the vertical. Adits, or tunnels, are the horizontal.
Mm-hmm.
So this was made, though Linker Adit was in existence, this was made to be more ADA friendly, so to have more traffic go through.
Right,
I'm going to show you a section that you'll see the actual size of the tunnels, and then you'll be very happy that we've opened it up.
<I'm sure.
laughs> But here at Reed Gold Mine, not so much. This was, like I said, this was a hobby.
Mm-hmm.
And you feel the temperature.
I feel the cool,
So underground, it's about 55 to 60 degrees year-round.
Okay.
And we usually have this door open. You can actually feel that all the way back there.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
This is amazing.
Yeah.
Wow.
So let's go on in.
So for real, back in the day, this is how
Should I close the door?
Yeah. No, you can keep it open.
Okay. I was like, keep that door open.
Because you feel that fresh air.
Yeah.
So the air is being sucked in and out through the tunnels and the shafts.
Wow.
So usually we leave it closed because no one's going to go in it, but
we're
clearly not going in it. So we're now underground.
Wow. This is amazing.
And
oh my gosh.
It's nice and wide and open.
Yeah, thank goodness.
Yeah.
Oh, close that door.
and you don't feel claustrophobic or like you're, you know, drinking in stale air.
That's true. That helps a lot. It's all about the air.
Yeah. So this is actually how big the tunnels were.
Oh my, this
is called a stope. And what a stope is essentially a section of the vein of white quartz that is taken out and tested to see how much gold percentage is.
Mm-hmm.
If there's a lot, then you know, you'll be walking through those veins.
Right.
If there's not, then you'll see these little areas that are dug out, stopes.
Mm.
This is what is left of this vein, obviously it didn't yield a lot of gold.
Oh, gotcha.
And this is what, think of two of you in this space.
Yeah. Oh my gosh, no.
Wow.
You know, this is like, I'm 5'3", so
right.
It's like 5'5", three and a half, two grown men with chisels and hammers, no electricity because they didn't have electricity.
Bro,
back
I was
then.
Gonna ask you that. I
got
that was
high.
That
how are y'all?
Definitely good.
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 That was my next question about the electricity. I figured they didn't have any.
Nope.
So no. Did they have mine? Not even mine was light. We can't have mine.
No.
Have electricity.
No, they didn't have carbide lamps at that time.
Right.
So what they had, candles.
Candles.
They had candles with clay or wax or something that would have them stick to the hat.
Okay.
Or they would bore a hole into the wall and insert an iron hook, a candle holder, essentially.
Yeah.
So no electricity whatsoever.
I figured that.
Yeah.
Oh my God. This makes it even hard.
And so think of those enslaved people who were forced to do this, not necessarily having the adequate clothing or the tools or anything, the skill, because you don't come to this knowing this. Those who actually helped with underground mining came from, Italy and came from Cornwall, England.
Right.
You know, those who actually understood mining for marble and for tin. Who understood how to architecturally be safe and sound.
Right.
They would come over and help make sure that these mines and Podunk Carolinas were actually safe for the Carolinians to work in.
This is amazing. And just the thought of that.
As you walk, you can sort of see, score marks and tool marks.
Right.
I mean, those are our ancestors right there.
Right.
Wow.
There's going to be some condensation.
Right.
And
so all these various.
Oh my God. Wow, there's a lot of veins in here.
Yeah.
I'm looking for gold.
Mm-hmm. All right, so since the entrances were vertical, and how would you be able to go in and out of it?
Right. Oh,
we have this lovely thing called a kibble. Mm. The kibble is that huge bucket right there.
Oh, I see.
And
that?
You can get inside. We'll switch places.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
You can get inside. You can put ore in there, rocks,
kibble.
Tools. And you'd have a horse or mule or men
get
hoisting
out.
Up.
Oh,
pulling them up the shaft. And this is one of the shafts. This is Linker Shaft.
Oh,
so you'll actually see the very top of this outside.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
And so this is all architecturally sound to us, but back in the
1800s,
this would be considered architecturally sound. And these things are called slow timbers, and essentially they are pinning the wall apart so that there's no movement.
Right.
And this wall on the right would be called the hanging wall, because it's the one that's more on top, and then the foot wall at the bottom. So look how much rock is behind those stall timbers.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah. That doesn't look very safe.
No. Which is why we're out here.
Yeah.
Exactly.
And of course, this mine that we're in right now, we're 50 feet below.
Mm-hmm.
If you go more than 50 feet below, then you start hitting water. So they have what is called water tables, which is right there.
Mm-hmm.
If you look in there, you can see how bone dry it is.
Mm.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's filled with water.
Mm.
So if it's filled with water, then you know that the shafts below are also filled with water.
Mm.
The tunnels below are also filled with water.
Mm.
And that's when you get the pumps and you pump water out so that you may still go down and work. But since it's bone dry, you know that everything below us is dry as well, and you can safely work underground.
Oh,
Again, those individuals who loan or rent those African Americans who don't have this knowledge and just care about getting a quick gold nugget.
Or sending people down there. This is really nice. I know we were going to be fascinated. I just didn't know how much.
Yeah.
It's a knowledge of
what
I'm saying. You know what I'm saying?
It's surprising how much, you know, and you want to share with people.
Exactly. Thank goodness. We so appreciate
this.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, this is, I mean personally.
going to make sure you want to
come. I appreciate that.
My name there. Yeah. So you on our show, right? In our own image for real.
Yeah. You are my big thing today.
So. Oh, I'm so glad you know the time.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, this is,
Yeah, you feel it?
Yeah.
You feel it, don't you?
So, wow, right here is where I prove to everyone that we are, in fact, 50 feet below. This is one of the shafts, the Morgan shaft. So you may look up.
Right. Oh, wow.
So that hanging right above us is the kibble, that bucket that we saw in the other shaft. So you can imagine getting inside and being slowly lowered down here. And of course, you have these platforms. You have these platforms because sometimes you can't wait for that.
Right.
And so you just run up the platforms, up the ladders.
That's amazing.
So did this mine eventually stop yielding as to why it's...
Yeah. 1835, there was, underground mining started in 1831 here, and then around 1835, there was, of course, a legal dispute, like you would have if you have a large family and many people working on the property. That shut this property down, this whole operation down for 10 years. And then John Reed, you know, they eventually, you know, settled out of court or what have you. John Reed died in 1845. This went to his grandson. And, you know, it started up again. It went in and out of a lot of different ownership hands until you have the Kellys in the 1890s. Then with them, 1896, the last substantial nugget was found. Then you have a little bit more work that's being done, and then eventually stopping altogether in 1912. Yeah,
1912.
So it shut down after John Reed died due to the Civil War, of course. And then it started back up again, in and out of hand. The Kellys, 1912, completely shut down. But you still have people in the area coming on the property and panning for gold and working the creek until the 1960s, actually. Yeah. And then the state purchased it, and we became Reed Gold Mine State Historic Site, 1977. Yeah. Open to the public in April.
Morgan Shaft.
Yep. So you'll notice a lot of these shafts, Hartzell, Creighton, Morgan, Linker, they're individuals who were in the area, who worked the property, who also married in the family.
Something else.
Now we're going to do a little labor. We can get an idea of what that labor was like for our descendants and our ancestors. So those, the dynamite we were talking about.
Do you have some in here?
No.
None, y'all are right.
So, like I said, this was an easy to rebuild mine, this pneumatic drill. But in order to make holes like this one, holes like that one, you'd have to do it by hand. So, pretend you have a sledgehammer.
Okay.
And we're going to make one of these holes, but we're not just going to make one for the dynamite. We're going to make several. So, I want to make one right here. So you have a sledgehammer, so you're going to hit the end of this.
So I'm hitting this.
And then I'm going to turn it, and then you're going to keep hitting it, and I'm going to keep turning it. So we're essentially going to bore a hole into the rock wall, and we're going to do this for many hours.
Hours, of course.
So we want to do that to get a substantial hole, like you see. And then we pack it with clay, put some hay in there, anything that the gunpowder can stay inside. And we take a little spoon, put it in the gunpowder, dip it, and then run a line, and then we blow it when we're outside. And you want to do this at the very end of the day, because if you blow it in the middle of the day, you have to wait for all the dust and the air to settle. If you run into the mine automatically after that happens, then you'll suffocate and die. So those individuals who didn't care, they probably may have sent an enslaved man in there to check things. And when they didn't come back out,
they know.
So you wait and do this at the very end of the day. Overnight, things settle. Then in the morning, you come back, you clear out the ore, you test it for gold, you send it to the stamp mill, you do whatever you have to do in order to extract that gold. And so all the gold from Reed Gold Mine, we think, came from this area called the gallery. And just stand here and look up, because it's kind of amazing.
Oh, wow.
So the very top of that is about 20 to 30 feet from the surface.
Mm.
And so the majority of the gold from the site actually came from this area. And this is where veins 1, 2, 3, and 4 kind of converge.
Aww.
And you can definitely see that they mined the heck out of this area.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
Now the actual entrance of Reed Gold Mine is engine shaft, which is actually through these barriers and that way.
Mm-hmm.
I've been behind the barriers and I've actually crawled in some of the tunnels that you can't even see it, that exist.
Mm-hmm.
It's fun, which is why I told my mother a week after I did this so that she wouldn't worry too much.
Exactly.
But to go back there, you'll see all sorts of things and kind of imagine what it used to look like when people could actually walk through.
Right.
We're going to head up this way. Please watch your head.
Okay.
Tall person.
Rock bolt.
I'm very aware of that. My brother's 6'9".
Right.
Wow. All
right, so this is vein number 4. So we are now 30 feet. And just to give you an idea, this goes down, but then it also goes up.
Oh,
and all the way back. So it's so deceptive. You think it's just going back, but it actually goes down, and then you climb up.
Oh, wow.
And then back even more.
Oh, my gosh.
Wow. Oh, wow. I think I kind of see a opening there.
Yeah.
Wow.
It's a lot. And so, you know, one of the veins, this is one of the veins, it continues from up here.
Mm-hmm.
And
I see a lot of sparkle on them rocks.
Passed by another
There's like condensite, you can't feel it all.
Tested, did not yield gold.
Wow. Oh, this is another one, huh?
Yeah. And then, you don't, you realize that you're surrounded by rock, but if you actually like look to see, this is like a literal ton of rock right here.
Yeah.
Oh, it's a loose.
Wow.
Huh? Or, no, okay.
And so you're, just imagine those stull timbers and rudimentary shoring this up architecturally, having those enslaved people work under here.
Oh my God.
Those free people working.
Wow.
Not getting the amount of money that they're due.
Sure. Right.
So.
On top of everything else. Oh my.
That's our mine.
Goodness.
Be careful heading up. We just redid these back stairs, which is why.
I can smell.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is all steel. Concrete.
Wow, that was something. That was such an experience. You feel it, right?
Yeah.
So you go down at the crack of dawn.
Wow.
Work from dark to dark, essentially.
Oh my gosh.
The first shaft that I had you guys in, that's the top right there.
Oh,
that's the top of Linker shaft.
Wow.
But Morgan shaft, where you actually saw the kibble hanging over you, is right there.
Oh, wow. So I didn't get a shot of that.
Ted A-frame, and that's essentially used to hold that kibble. And you just use the pulley, pull it up, pull it down. Whenever someone needs to get out, get in, take tools in or out, rock.
It had to be some accidents. I mean, it must have been.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my. Can you imagine that?
Yeah.
Would you get in there and trust that the people get you up and down?
Well, only if I didn't have a choice.
Wow. Yeah, I feel that. This is amazing. So now, how long have you been here at this particular site? And
it will be 3 years in July.
You're doing amazing work.
Thank you.
Anything we could do to, I know more people that come, the more successful is the program that you have.
Yeah.
The longer you'll stay here. And that's what we want.
And honestly, I've told people, you know, I'll come to you. I'll talk. You know, I'm more than happy to do that because... For me, that's community outreach.
I'm so glad you did that, because that's what you were doing at local.
Yeah.
How do you find these particular places? Do you just ask around? Do your own research?
A lot of people come to us.
That's good.
My friend Angela Thorpe is the assistant director of the African American Heritage Commission.
Good.
And she was actually at James K. Polk State Historic Site as an interpreter. And so she knows that we're kind of the same.
Right.
And so she constantly tries to send things my way and promote.
I'm so glad to know.
And that's great because she understands.
She understands.
So,
yeah.
Good. She's trying to lift us up in historic sites.
Exactly.
And in North Carolina.
Definitely.
So,
really, I'm so glad because I don't remember ever seeing us at a historic site when I was a child going
yeah.
on school
yeah.
trips. Do you?
Yeah.
We were never there.
So she said, Sarah, apply to do a presentation
right.
at the kickoff.
Yes.
And instead they said, hey, set up a table and talk.
Good.
And
mm.
I actually prefer that because doing a presentation, I would have just been there for about 45
right.
minutes.
Yeah.
But instead I had a table,
yeah.
I had artifacts and things that people could touch
yeah.
and I could actually interact with
yeah.
people.
It was nice.
And I prefer that. Absolutely. That way, I mean, I had 200 handbills that
wow.
were gone
wow.
and 200 for the Black History Program that were gone.
Wow. Mm.
So I knew I reached a lot of
a
people
lot.
Yeah.
more so than I would have
exactly.
If I did a presentation.
Yeah.
Then, you know,
yes,
being
exactly.
African
presence. That's right.
So
yeah,
we have all
like
of these things
right
here.
Wow. And this is all gold.
Yep.
Wow, even this, the frame
the
and
yeah.
oh my. I would love, could you give me a frame, gold frame?
Oh, well. I got a leaf.
That's true, you can mm. do it yourself. Wow.
Yeah,
you can put gold in your canes.
Oh, do you?
Yeah, gold.
Oh, oh good. And you can put it in your, you ever think about putting gold in your sticks?
Yeah, well,
oh,
see?
Wow.
Sarah's going to have a gold
exactly.
stick.
And need some pieces.
Gold. Silver.
Oh,
no,
definitely.
It's not favorite call.
I got
silverware.
Right.
Goldware.
Yeah. I love it. Necklace,
look at that cup.
Cup and saucer. Yeah, see, I love that. Can you imagine? I would love to have that.
All right, babe, it's yours.
That's fine. That's fine. That's all I said.
Take it.
Yeah. Yeah,
I love it. Mm-hmm. Wow, glass.
Oh, it shows your cell phones and.
Oh, that is so cool.
Computer boards.
Love that. High tech gold.
Yeah. So this gold right here is actually. Reed gold mine gold.
Oh, wow.
You see how it's sort of a little
yeah.
greenish, a little brownish.
Yeah.
That's raw, unrefined.
Wow.
Is that
wow.
a bill that has gold in it?
Yep.
Oh wow, they don't have that anymore, I'm sure.
No, not that big anyway.
Yeah, that is.
That's from 1922, I believe.
1922.
Gold standard.
And gold coin, wow.
And it's real.
Yeah.
Wow, and look at Errol H. Kings, the only ones who can wear gold, yeah, this.
Early mining information.
Wow, so what do you exchange it?
And
this
then,
is tobacco, huh?
That is tobacco.
Oh, wow.
And so you have, like, the volcanic activity, different types of tanning for gold and such. You have Conrad.
Mm-hmm.
And then you come around this corner, and this is all it says about trophies
oh.
and women.
Same old thing.
Blacks and women.
Oh, and women, of course, because we can't be left
this
alone.
Wow, shameful.
And but even the word, though, just that one word is still powerful, extensively
yeah.
used.
Mm-hmm.
We were there.
Most of slaves either owned or rented.
Wow.
5,000 to have worked in Burke County alone.
Wow.
Few slaves bought their freedom with gold. They earned or found.
Yeah, exactly. On that, but wow.
Yeah.
That's
so this
it.
Is the only panel that mentioned
what? Of course I can remember.
So I saw
yeah.
that. I'm like, okay, there's got to be more to this story. And that's the only thing out of this entire exhibit area. So this is why I created the program.
I had to,
just based off of that.
So you think that may change because of what you're doing?
I'm hoping. If I can continue with this relationship with the Black Reeds, and I can get stories from them, if I can get picture sites, if I have those things, then I'll be able to put forth a proposal to create, you know, a little section that's not this, but might be this.
Of course, at least, right?
That's dedicated to African Americans in the mining industry.
Right.
That is a possibility.
Wow.
Are the Reeds enthusiastic about?
I was invited to their first family reunion last
summer.
Wow. I'm invited to their family reunion this summer.
Right on.
And I'm on their Facebook page for their family.
Great.
Right
and
on.
So we keep in contact. I've given them copies of court minutes, and they keep in contact with me, asking me questions and such.
Wow.
So we're they see me as family, because right. they appreciate the fact that I'm trying to tell their story.
Right on.
I love it. I love it. And what was the life? I don't know if I asked this quite. What was the life of a minor? I mean, were they separated from their family? Wasn't it kind of like a day job where you go to work and you get to come back home?
Yeah.
It's
kind of like a day job. Okay. Some just like, you know, African American men who went off and mm-hmm. tried to get some sort of work.
Right.
Some obviously were like that as well. Mm-hmm. But like I said, those boom towns that were created, right. some of the families just followed along with them gotcha. And just stayed sure. in these yeah. created little cities and towns. Right. Some were part of an actual crew, mm-hmm. and so they would come to the Reed Gold Mine, or they would go mm-hmm. to Charlotte and work at the Rudisill Mine or the St. Catherine's Mine, mm-hmm. and they would just be one of many rotations of crews. Mm-hmm. So,
gotcha.
Wow. It all depended on the need, the demand.
These boxes are kind of cool. Mm-hmm. Is this where the dining room was held?
Yep.
Yes.
Gunpowder, all those explosives would be in those boxes.
Wow.
Those are the lamps that you could attach to your helmet.
Oh, okay, so that was the beginning. Mm.
Yeah, that was kind of the next step. Yeah. You have the oil, you put it in there, okay. and then light it.
Wow.
And lots of different tools, drills, wheelbarrow.
Wow.
So all of these were used, of course, in mining.
Mm-hmm.
Underground, and then all of these machines, you have winches and coils and pulleys mm-hmm. to pull hoist.
Mm-hmm.
So this is how they would go in and out of the shafts.
Oh wow.
You have, you know, horses or mules mm-hmm. and they just be hanging
gotcha.
Out.
Yep. Wow. Yeah, it's kind of amazing to think about that.
That huge piece of stone we saw over there, mm. you break it down and feed it into this machine, the jaw crusher,
okay.
you break it down even more.
Okay.
And then to show you the different size rocks, mm. so you have big rocks from underground, and then you feed these big rocks into the jaw crusher so they become smaller.
Okay.
And they're small enough, you can feed them into the hopper, mm. the stamp mill, and it comes out like this
oh, wow.
after it's crushed.
Gotcha.
There was one last chance to capture the remaining.
These are part of the stamp. Mm-hmm. That's the shoe. But all of these, this whole thing is mm-hmm. 750 pounds.
Mm.
This is one of the shoes for some of the stamps.
Oh, wow.
And of course, they each weigh different poundage. But I'll let you play around with that.
Oh, yeah.
It's
so heavy. Yeah, I could look at it. Yeah, exactly. We need you to drive it.
Yeah, that is heavy.
But yeah, this is all the machinery.
Wow.
And then, of course, lots of people don't realize that we also talk about geology. Since mm-hmm. we talk about Volpe, we have to talk
right.
about geology.
Yeah.
So, Volpe materials, they actually gave us this lovely teaching collection. And these are different examples of what you can mine from underground that is used in everyday
items. Yeah,
makeup, baby powder,
wow.
batteries,
right.
Pepsi cans.
Yes. Wow. Mm-hmm. Wow.
So that's Reed Goldman.
Hammering. Oh, well, my hammer's in the wind, boy. Hammering. Oh, well, my hammer's in the wind, boy. Hammering. Oh, well, I'm a ringer for the governor, boy. Hammering. Oh, well, I'm a ringer for the governor, boy. Hammering. Oh, well, governor, don't you hear me? Hammering. Oh, well, governor, don't you hear me? Hammering. Oh, well, I want to go.
Peace and blessings. So this is the end of our show, and it was a long one. You know, I wanted to make sure you got 2 hours this time because I know we missed a couple of months. And we wanted to make sure we bring you something that was really, you know, kind of coming in a way that's going to make you think, that's going to make you reflect, but that's also going to help you to rejoice. You know, we did visit the Ruiz Gold Mine, and I want to thank so much Sarah Blanchett for being our guide, our historic guide on this tour. I hope that you are going to try those kale chips. They are delicious. You'll never have regular chips again. It takes a little preparation, but it's absolutely worth it. And also, I hope you think about actually investing in some masks that actually speak to you, because that's the most important thing. And lastly, y'all, get out there and do some color. Be colorful, be beautiful, be bright. The spring is coming. And please look forward to our next In Our Own Image, where we'll be interviewing a dear sister named Professor Linda Dallas from St. Augustine School, a historical black college and university. And I think you're going to love it. I'll see you in the next show. And I hope your day is beautiful. This is Lisa Marie Goodson of the Afrocentric Home Decor and Style Channel, In Our Own Image. Peace and blessings. Thank you.